It's a pleasure addressing all of you for this wonderful workshop which started yesterday. It is 10:29 a.m. Till for next 1 minute or for next few seconds, we'll be having a general chit chat, and then we'll be starting formally with the session. In the meantime, as you can see, the title for today's session is Use of Bloom's Taxonomy for Assessing Learning Outcomes. And while I was preparing for this session, I thought of that I must show you a picture of this great man, Bloom, Benjamin Bloom as well, and with whose name this Bloom's Taxonomy term has been used everywhere, and it is a very, very popular term in the education arena. So as it can be checked, as can be seen from first slide also, that Bloom's Taxonomy was created by Benjamin Bloom in 1956. And in fact, there were some co-creators of this Bloom's Taxonomy as well, whose names are not very frequently used in day-to-day working. But I think we should acknowledge their effort also. So besides Benjamin Bloom, there were Engelhardt, MD, and then Hill, Kraft, Wohi. And the first set of results was published in a book by David Mackay Company in 1956. And from there, the whole thinking about how the assessment should be conducted, how the teaching should be done, that got changed. In fact, there have been many, many different versions of Bloom's Taxonomy as well, revised versions of Bloom's Taxonomy as well. And in today's session, we'll be talking about that how Bloom's Taxonomy can be used effectively for framing right set of questions while assessing the students. Right? We, in yesterday's session, Dr. Archana Mantri and Dr. Vijay Kumar Jadhav did a wonderful job. We'll be having a quick summary of their sessions as well. See, as it is very clear, mandate given by AICTE, that we are organizing this workshop on examination reforms with a set objective. And the objective is that we really want to walk you through the stepwise procedure proposed in policy document. I'm sure you must have seen that policy document on examination reforms. If not, then it is very much available on AICT website also, which will help to improve the quality of assessments to produce employable professionals who are self-enablers. When we use this word employable professionals, I'm sure all of us will agree that the numbers have been bothering for all of us as educators. World across, it is told that over 70% of manpower is not employable or 80% of manpower is not employable. It's different agencies do make different kind of tall claims. And I'm sure as academicians, as teachers, we will agree to this fact that this is our joint responsibility to train our students in such a way that they are thorough professionals and they are self-enablers. And hence this whole workshop is being organized with that kind of thought process in mind. And the major outcome which we really foresee as the outcome as after the completion of this workshop is that one should be able to understand all levels of Bloom's Taxonomy very, very well. And then simultaneously, to assess attainment of program outcomes based on principles of outcome-based education of Washington Accord. About Washington Accord, Professor Vijay Jadhav talked in detail in yesterday's session. And simultaneously, one of the major goals for today's session is that I should be able to tell you that how to frame different set of questions pertaining to different levels of Bloom's Taxonomy. And then, in forthcoming session, the afternoon session today, which will be taken by Professor Shivani Malhotra, how the performance indicators are going to be aligned. And since the workshops started yesterday, first session, as it has been told, 10:32 a.m. to 12 p.m. first session was context setting, which was taken by Professor Archana Mantri, Vice Chancellor of Chitara University. Second session, need for outcome-based education, very well addressed session by Dr. Vijay Jadhav, and then understanding graduate attributes, competencies, and performance indicators, etc. That session was taken in the afternoon, that is was from 12:15 to 2:15 p.m. And here we stand today, session 3, that is use of Bloom's taxonomy for design of questions. And then very, very important is that you will see in the coming slides also, in the whole session also, that we can raise the level of questions pertaining to same topic by asking the questions in different manner, right? So we'll be talking about that. It's going to be very, very interesting, I'm very sure. Session 4 will be taken by Professor Shivani Malhotra, as I already told. And then tomorrow, we'll be having thorough discussion on some sample question papers, which you will people will need to prepare, and we'll be having thorough discussion on that also. Now, here is goes the poll question 1. It's very important for me to know that who are the attendees. Because yesterday's session, I was also one of the attendees. Well, I was attending and I could notice that there are more than 1,000 odd attendees. So please participate in this poll. I would request my IT team to kindly enable this poll, activate this poll, and let me get an idea that how many people attendees participated in, didn't attend at all, both the sessions, because two sessions were conducted yesterday. That no session, they didn't attend any session. How many of you attended session 1 only? How many of you attended session 2 only? And how many of you attended both the sessions? Okay, very nice, very nice. So I'm getting to see the poll results also. Only 3% of people are there who couldn't attend any session due to whatsoever reason. Are only 6% are there who attended both the sessions. We can end the poll, so that is a good indication that we are having maximum people in this session who attended both the sessions. That's really wonderful, very wonderful. So that way, that gives me a lot of satisfaction to note that also, that the participants are very much interested in attending this workshop and making sure that examination reforms happen in their respective institutes also. Okay, here is a quick, can we just end this poll, please? Yeah. Yes. To make a quick summary of two sessions which were conducted yesterday, very, very quick summary. In fact, both the sessions have been summarized only in two slides. In session 1, Dr. Arshana Mantri insisted upon that why reforms in examination are important. And it's a very important statement, the first one which has been written over there, that traditional examinations carry least priority in curricular domains and are left as last thing to do. They test the content, not the knowledge and skills gained by students. While we all understand, we all appreciate, what we are supposed to test is their knowledge and skill. Then they do not motivate the students to learn and are just means to grade the students. While effort should be that when student is appearing in a test, he goes with this thought that, yes, I have learned something and I'm here to prove myself, not to prove exactly, but to make a statement that, yes, I have learned this subject. But then most of the time, assessments become a tool to grade the students only. And students are also happy if they are getting good grades in their examination, even without learning anything. They do think that, okay, they have done their job well. And at times, instructors also do think that, okay, their job is done. But that is not how it should be. Hence, examination reforms are very, very important. Then simultaneously, there is another thing, that they are too complicated. The assessments which are set, either those are too complicated and difficult, or these are too easy and low level to test the learning outcomes. Professor Vijay Jadhav also talked in yesterday's session that the learning outcomes, setting right learning outcomes of any course are very, very important. Now, if our assessments fail to test the learning outcomes of any course, it means we have not set the right kind of assessments. Another thing, most of the assessments which we organize, they test what the students may not know, rather what the students ought to know, right? I'm very sure you all will agree to this statement also, that we are supposed to test in the assessments. At the end of the course, these are the things which students should be knowing. If we are not doing that, it means we have not set a good question paper. We have not set a right kind of assessment. Another thing, assessment should be designed to test higher level objectives in the courses. Lower level objectives, setting the all the questions only at the remembering or understanding level. That way we are not going to, again, we are not doing enough good job in setting the right kind of assessments. Dr. Mantri, yesterday's session might have given you a kind of case study to read as well. And you must be remembering the cases of these three students, Rohan, Ria, and Rinku, right? And then while attempting any test, the student should be motivated to learn more. That was the outcome, or that was a quick summary of session one of which was presented by Dr. Archana. Second session provided by Dr. Vijay Jadhav, wonderful session. He made all of you understand that why it is important to have terms, the terms which we perhaps when we were students, we had never heard terms like course learning outcomes or program outcomes. We had never heard of this or graduate attributes, etc. But owing to now India being a permanent signatory to Washington Accord, which happened in 2014, and NBA is the representing agency from India, we have been talking more frequently about 12 graduate attributes, which have been written in this type: engineering knowledge, problem analysis, design development of solutions, investigation, modern tools usage, the engineer and the society. Very important, lifelong learning, communication. These are the skills which perhaps we used to inherit ourselves, but we never spent enough of time in tabulating these skills and never preparing our assessments in a way so that these skills should also be tested by setting any assessment. And again, Professor Vijay very beautifully gave examples that how different course outcomes can be mapped with program outcomes. And then how program outcomes, we can have different performance indicators to assess those program outcomes as well. I'm sure you must have appreciated the contents of both those sessions by very learned speakers yesterday. So at the end of this session, today's session, the participants will be able to clearly identify the corresponding Bloom's taxonomy level for questions. I'll be showing you a large number of questions, as many as around 15 to 20 different questions. First, I'll be giving you some examples that here is a question statement, and this is, it pertains to this particular level of Bloom's taxonomy. And then we'll be having a poll, set of poll questions where you will be writing down that this particular statement should align with which particular level of Bloom's taxonomy. I'm sure after the end of the session at 12 noon, you should be able to identify even your question papers, all the questions asked in your question papers very, very clearly that to which Bloom's taxonomy level those questions exactly align. So that is one of the objectives of this session. Then simultaneously, when you would have attended this session, you would have written appropriate set of CLOs, course learning outcomes, you should be able to write using Bloom's taxonomy and keywords. Another thing, that is a part of the assignment as well, which you'll be getting to do today, that you'll be needing to set at least one set of questions for your course, which can test high level of knowledge. This is what you should be able to do as a part of the assignment, which will be given today. You will be asked to submit at least one question paper of your subject, whichever subject you are teaching, whatsoever subject you feel you are a master of. And then accordingly align all those questions with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy, right? And this is what the expectation is. Let us perform three reality checks, right? And I would give you 1 odd minute, whatsoever. I do have a notebook with me. I'm sure you would also have been some notebook, some notepad in front of you. I really request you to write down what students do in the class and what they need to do at work. Please write down in the chat window also what students do in the class, right? if I have to answer this question, I'd be writing down a couple of things. They prepare notes in the classes, right? So their listening skill is important. Their understanding skill is important. This is what I am writing for what students do in the class, right? And simultaneously, if I need to write what they need to do at work, what they need to do at work, so they need to be obviously very good listeners. They should be able to solve real life problems. Very, very important statement which I'm making. They should be able to solve real life problems, right? What else do they do in the class? Please keep on writing down in the chat window what students do in the class and what they need to do at work. So what I have written down, so they in the class, they listen, they understand, they prepare notes, and then they try to score good marks. Very, very important for them, good marks or good grades. The things which they don't understand, they try to cram those things also, right? This is what they do in the class. And what they need to do at work, they need to solve real life problems. This is what I have written. What else? Please come up with a few more answers. Oh, I can check this thing. Can you show me the question and answers? And chat. Please write down the chat on Q&A. Okay. The Q&A. Yeah, try to understand. Very good. Taking notes. Yes. They take on notes. They need to, yes, prepare notes, listen to class. Very good. Yes. Okay. And then they prepare for exams. Yes. Try to explore concepts with discussion. Very good. Very good. So there has been good participation. Yeah. Please close this window. Yeah. So I'm very sure when this one odd minute has been given to you to think particularly only about this, you must have realized that there are differences. What they do in the class and what they need to do at work, right? We're not going to discuss it in many detail, but I just want to give you one moment, 1 minute of focused time, concentrated time, where you can ask yourself that what is the exactly the requirement at their workplace? And what exactly is the requirement when they're, what exactly is the requirement when they're attending the classes? Reality check number one was. Reality check number two, right? I have put a weighing scale there. And left side, on my right side, how much do we teach? It's always more, very heavy. How much they're able to understand, how much they're able to retain, how much they're able to connect with real life, and how much they're finally able to apply. I'm very sure, again, if we give ourselves a little bit of time to think about this scenario, I'm sure you will all agree with that. There have been statements by many, many renowned scholars that when they get to do something, the best way to learn is when they get to actually do something, when they're put into real life situations. That is a time when they get to learn maximum of the things also, right? These reality checks are for all of us, not individually for me or individually for any one of you, but it is for the whole teaching community. Reality check number three says, this picture represents basically, let me tell you, all students come, if you're taking a teaching a class of say 60 odd students, I'm sure we'll appreciate that all 60 come from different kind of backgrounds. Their motivation level to attend your classes are different. Their learning habits are different. Their learning styles are different. Their atmosphere at their respective homes are different. So all learners are very, very different. I'm taking a pause for 10 seconds over here and really request you to think about this thing. Is it true? Yes, it is true. So in a class of 60 students, 100 students, whatever is the size of the class, all learners do come with different kind of ability. And if I have to summarize all these three reality checks, I can easily summarize like, What students learn is always less than what we teach. Fact one. Fact two, how much they learn is always determined by their native background. I told in the last slide. Background in the course topic, motivation for taking that particular course, and match between their learning style and our teaching style. And fact three, very important fact, we can't do much about their ability, background, motivation, or learning style. Although we can work extremely hard, but perhaps we will not be able to do much about the same. So to maximize learning, students' learning, all what we have to do is that we have to work simultaneously on our teaching ability also. If the learning abilities are different, so it means we have to have different levels of learning, assessments also. Different levels of assessment should also be conducted. So here I come with the straightway with the first slide where I'm showing the Bloom's taxonomy. Yesterday's session, Professor Vijay Jadhav also showed you this kind of pyramid. There are six levels of learning: remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. On my right side, this is first pyramid of Bloom's taxonomy, the roots of which were given in 1956, as I told you in the first slide also, by Benjamin Bloom and his team. Then over the years, there have been many variations, many revisions to this Bloom's taxonomy level as well. And if we need to, basically the purpose is we should have a system by keeping student at the center. All the learning objectives should be achieved. For that, we do have the Bloom's taxonomy, program outcomes, and then instructor goal should be met. Simultaneously, on the other hand, on my left side of the screen here, it is all the instructions. When we give instructions to students, means when we are teaching, we teach them through lectures, we teach them through labs, active and cooperative learning, we try to ensure we do have different terms like problem-based learning. Then we use so many other techniques, basically, to make sure that our students ultimately learn. And overall, this all is assessed finally in different ways through tests, through surveys, through other measures, and then usual classroom assessment techniques also, where we tell them, okay, please raise your hand, whether you have understood this concept or not. We will give them some small poll kind of questions as well. Ultimately, with this aim that students should be able to learn well, and there is a fact. The learning that how seriously a course has been taught, with what kind of approach a course has been taught, that can very easily be understood that what kind of question paper has been set for a particular course. If the question paper is more of application oriented, more of application, real life problems have been asked in the question paper, it means teacher has taken that kind of effort to make sure that the learning also has been of that kind only. More of real life problems must have been given in the classes as well. But if the question paper itself satisfies only first two levels of Bloom's taxonomy here, as shown in the slide, like it's only remembering and understanding, that means that the teaching has also been mostly pertaining to only those two levels or first three levels. So very important to ensure this thing, that the question papers which we do set, they should be able to test all levels of learning and all levels of learning satisfying all levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And that will happen when we would have taken that kind of, when we would have exercised that kind of caution in making sure that our teaching also is of all six levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And levels are remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and finally, ability to create also. Now, all these six levels of Bloom's taxonomy cannot be checked or cannot be assessed by only a certain set of, say, end-term examination or by a written pen and paper examination. There is definitely an overlap for two of levels, likewise applying and analyzing, But first four levels can usually be assessed by examinations or assignments which we conduct for our students. Which four levels? Remembering, understanding, applying, and analyzing. For assessing these four levels of learning, we do have usual examinations and assignments. Now, creating and evaluating, those are obviously very higher levels of learning. To assess those, usually the kind of assessment tools which we do have in our education system, that is projects, seminars are there, case studies, industrial trainings, and then internship. As this triangle shows, there is an overlap between middle two levels, that is applying and analyzing. These are two levels which can be assessed by examinations and assignments, as well as using our other assessment tools like projects, seminars, case studies, industrial training, and internship. For the time being, my request to you would be just try to digest this thing. Just try to digest the contents of this triangle. We'll be talking about this thing in more detail with a lot of examples in coming few slides. Now, Professor Vijay talked about this as well yesterday, and I have also just said this thing. It is very important that every course must have course learning outcomes. And then there is a very pertinent need to align these course learning outcomes with your assessments also, right? So ideally all levels should be addressed in every course when you're teaching, and ideally all levels should be assessed in every course when you're setting the question papers. Very important statements. I repeat, ideally all levels should be addressed in every course while teaching, right? And ideally all levels should be assessed in every course when you're setting a examination, when you're setting a particular question paper. And again, when we are designing the assessments, teaching pedagogy has to be kept in mind. Just think for these one, think for all these answers to these questions. Again, think for the answer to these questions for yourself. When you set the course learning outcomes, or when you set the teaching pedagogy for a course, or when you set the assessment for any course, spend some time on answering these questions for yourself. What enabling knowledge and skills are required at the end of this course? What knowledge and what skills student must have acquired at the end of this course? What kind of activities you should conduct at the time of teaching so that those knowledge and skills students should be able to equip themselves? What and how to be taught in light of the performance course? So every course will be having some kind of performance course. Think, spend some time on understanding or visualizing this thing, that in what particular way, what will be the best way to ensure that you will be teaching a particular concept in a way and those performance course will be achieved. Again, if you're teaching whatsoever course you're teaching, whether it's a course on mechanics on solids, or whether it's a course on electronic devices, or whether it's a course on programming language, what are the best materials and resources you'd be needing to teach those courses? What are the best textbooks for those courses? Are the textbooks which you're using, those are error-free? There are no mistakes on those courses. Do you need any kind of additional websites as well? I remember our Chitara University faculty members assess a lot of wonderful websites as well while teaching some courses, right? Where useful information about that course is available, which is not available, say, in any textbook also. What assessment strategy will be best suitable? Whether it has to be a practical examination, or it has to be a theoretical examination, how you'll be able to assess them in the best possible manner, whether the question paper should be more of MCQ based, multiple choice question based, or the question paper should be having more of short numericals, or whether the question paper should be having more of fill in the blanks kind of questions, or whether the course should be having, whether the assessment should be having more of long numerical problems, etc. Think through yourself where exactly is the requirement of this course, whatsoever course you are teaching, whether it's a programming language course or whether it's a whatsoever course, it's a workshop practice course, where exactly the application of this course lies in. Accordingly, please think of that how you should be teaching that course so that the maximum of the student is able to understand and appreciate the course in the best possible manner. And at the end of the course, he would have acquired the maximum knowledge and all required skills to practice that course also. Then is the overall design, whatsoever way you are designing your course learning outcomes or you are designing your assessments, are those coherent? Are those effectively, finally effective or not? So for this slide, very important request to you, if you want to write down, obviously perhaps the slides will be made available to you later also, write down, think through deeply before a particular course is offered. When you're planning to offer a course, try to get the answers of all these questions for yourself. Then accordingly, when you will be trying to do it, the learning outcomes for entire course, so those would be general in nature, usually around 6 to 10, and should be written something like this: at the completion of this course, you will be able to do what, right? You will be able to do this, these particular things after the completion of this course. At the completion of this particular chapter or module, you will be able to do this. Remember, in the beginning of the session, how we have framed the learning outcomes of this particular session only. What was told? At the end of this session, you will be able to do this. And one of the outcomes which was there, that you will be able to identify the questions which you only set in your question papers, and you will be able to align those questions with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. So make the student understand this thing, that what he'll be able to do after learning this particular course, after learning this particular chapter. Similarly, and then it should go down to before the start of every lecture, at the end of this particular lecture, at the end of this particular assessment which you are setting, right? You should be clear about that the student should be able to do all these things. If we try to align our teaching pedagogy and our assessment techniques while thinking through, while trying to get off the answers of all these questions, I'm sure we'll be able to set some very, very nice question papers, which students will be able to appreciate in a very, very big manner. Then there are some attributes of course outcome as well. Set the expectations of students and instructor. We should be able to use some action verbs. It is clearly written, avoid words like, what words? Understand, appreciate. Rather, what are important is, use action verbs like compute, analyze, design, formulate, solve. Now, if we think that in our question papers, we are going to set our questions while keeping, say, these common words in mind, trust me, the whole approach, whole thought process of setting the question papers itself gets completely changed. If we think that I'm not going to ask a question like discuss, write a short note on, describe, right, distinguish between, if I pledge that I'm not going to ask any of these kind of questions, and I'm going to ask questions, my question statements themselves are going to be more of action oriented, compute, analyze, design, formulate, solve, create. If these are the kind of words which my question paper is going to have, the whole thought process about setting a application oriented question paper based on Bloom's taxonomy level will completely change, and will be able to set very, very wonderful question papers. Again, coming on to showing you the different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. All six levels are extremely important. This is what I was told in the earlier slides also, that when we set an assessment, it is very important to assess the student from all six levels. What are the questions? What kind of questions should be addressed or should be aligned with first level of Bloom's taxonomy? Remembering. See, the common belief is that at the end of every course, when you teach any course, there are some things which the student has to remember with for the rest of his life. Always remember. Likewise, I teach a course on, say, electronic devices. And I know student must remember what is the band gap. So likewise, energy band gap of two most common semiconductors. One is silicon and germanium. So silicon energy band gap is 1.1 electron volt. And germanium energy band gap is 0.7 electron volt. So this kind of question, if asked in the question paper, this definitely gets aligned with remembering level. And as an instructor, as a teacher, I would always expect that student, when he would have passed this particular course, when he would have attempted the test for that particular course, he should be remembering these things for the rest of his life. So any questions which you feel that the student should be remembering always, that should go to the remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. Then understanding different words which have been written here. Once, likewise, explain, interpret, classify, compare, likewise, observations and concepts, etc. Those all get aligned with understanding level of Bloom's taxonomy. Apply known procedures to novel problems. That aligns with applying level of Bloom's taxonomy. Then explain, interpret, predict the behavior of a system. There is already a sound system which is already existing over there. And you're supposed to predict how this system is going to perform under a particular set of conditions. That is analysis. That is analyzing level of Bloom's taxonomy. Then make criteria-based judgments. Choose, prioritize, rate, critic, that is evaluating. And I'm very sure as teacher would be able to appreciate these higher levels of Bloom's taxonomy, higher levels of learning are very, very important for students to become thorough professionals. Many a times in their professional career, they will need to make very, very important decision. Choose between two particular scenarios, which one is better for the organization. Prioritize between three different tasks, which is the most important task, right? Rate, similarly critic. So all these skills are very, very important and should be assessed in any assessment. Then create is obviously a very higher level of skill, learning skill, but as academicians, as teachers, we should find ways and means to test this particular skill of student also, creating. And as it was told in a couple of slides earlier, that creating, evaluating, analyzing, and applying can be assessed with our evaluation components like internships, right, like projects, like seminars, etc. Remembering, understanding are the skills which are relatively lower order skills, can be assessed in our usual class assignments, our mid-semester tests, our end-term examination, etc. Very important, each skill involves the skill below it, usually, and it means when you're trying to set a question paper or a question basically for creating level of Bloom's taxonomy level, you will automatically be assessing somehow his evaluating ability also, right? When you'll be setting a question for, say, understanding level of Bloom's taxonomy, that is not possible if we would not be able to remember a couple of things also. So the point is, each skill involves the skills below it also. And this is very much easily appreciable that usually undergraduate education deals mostly with remembering, understanding, and applying. But ideally, all Bloom's levels should be addressed in every course as it is being insisted time and again. Here, in next few slides, what I am going to do is going to show you some questions which should be aligned with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Likewise, remember. Remembering is like retrieving, recognizing, and recalling relevant knowledge from long-term memory. What are the common words which can be used in question papers to test the remembering skill of the student? List couple of things. Define, you can ask a definition. Tell, describe, recite, recall, identify, show, label. There is some, you give some diagram and to ask them to label it. Likewise, in school examination, they would be showing India map and they'd be telling, okay, identify, label, where is Punjab, where is Tamil Nadu, where is Maharashtra, where is Karnataka. Student will be able to do that labeling properly if he remembers that. So pure test of remembering power of the student strictly gets aligned with remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. Tabulate, quote, name, who gave, say, three laws of motion. So Newton, right? You need to remember it. Who, when, ask something like, when India got independence, so when, 1947, we need to remember it. There is nothing much to understand. There is nothing much to create. There is nothing to evaluate. You need to remember these things. So all these kind of questions for which some words have been written over there, all these kind of questions should be aligned with remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. Likewise, some sample questions have been written. Only 5 odd questions have been shown here in this particular slide. But simultaneously, I would encourage you to go through the AICT, those examination reforms book also, booklet, very wonderfully prepared book, where you'll be finding many more questions relating to different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And you'll be able to get more idea that what levels, what kind of questions should align with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. State Ohm's law, list the physical and chemical properties of silicon. Now it's list the components of A to D converter, analog to digital converter. It is list, it's remembering. List the arithmetic operators available in C language in increasing order of precedence. Again, it's list, remembering level. Define the purpose of a constructor. Again, define, which typically is remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. Let's come on to the next understanding, second level of Bloom's taxonomy. Understanding construct meaning from oral, written and graphic messages through interpreting, exemplifying, classifying, summarizing, inferring, comparing, and explaining. All these kind of skills get aligned with understanding level of Bloom's taxonomy. And typical words which you can use, describe, explain, paraphrase, restate, associate, contrast, summarize, differentiate, interpret, discuss, typically assessing the understanding level of Bloom's taxonomy. Examples like explain the importance of sustainability in engineering design. How does a PN junction diode behaves under different bias conditions? Now, one would not be able to answer this question if he doesn't understand the concept of PN junction diode. Describe the characteristics of silicon controlled rectifier, SCR, and transistor equivalent for a SCR. Explain the terms particle, rigid body, and deformable body, giving 2 examples of each. Discuss the effect of Make in India initiative on the Indian manufacturing industry. Now, you all will agree, they will be able to understand, they will be able to reply to these questions well, only if they have understood the subject well. And as was told, that every level of Bloom's taxonomy simultaneously checks the one level below also. Some of the things, likewise, how does a PN junction diode behaves under different bias conditions, is automatically remembering thing for some of the fundamentals will also be automatically assessed. Another is application. So likewise, calculate, predict, apply, solve, illustrate, use, demonstrate, determine, model, experiment, show, examine, modify. All this pertain to application level of Bloom's taxonomy. And there are some beautiful examples which have been given over here. And as I told earlier also, I would strongly encourage you to go through that booklet of AICT also, examination reforms booklet, to have look out more of such questions also. I would just read out one question statement here. One of the resource person needs to address a huge crowd, nearly 400 members in the auditorium. A system is to be designed in such a way that everybody attending the session should be able to hear properly and clearly without any disturbance. Identify the suitable circuit to boost the voice signal and explain its functionality in brief. Clear example of that, the student has to apply his knowledge of this particular subject so as to identify the suitable circuit for to solve this real life problem. Let's go to the next level. It is analyze. And typical words which can be used to set the questions pertaining to analyze level of Bloom's taxonomy: classify, outline, likewise breakdown, right? Categorize, analyze again. Then you may ask them to draw some diagram. Then illustrate, infer from a particular situation, select, give them a choice among different options, and then select, ask them to select the best option. Some sample questions likewise: a class of 10 students consists of 5 males and 5 females. We intend to train a model based on their past scores to predict the future score. The average score of females is 60, whereas that of male is 80. The overall average of the class is 70. Give 2 ways of predicting the score and analyze them for the fitting model. Beautiful problem statement. Typical problem pertaining to analyze level of Bloom's taxonomy. Then return statement can only be used to return a single value. Can multiple values be returned from a function? Justify your answer. And this student would be able to do if he has understood the subject well, and if he would be able to analyze this particular situation in a particular way, then only he would be able to address this particular question. Then evaluating and creating, as it has been told time and again, these are all both higher levels of learning. And typical, as you can imagine, the kind of level, the kind of words which can go for this evaluating, creating level: calculate, predict, apply this knowledge, solve, illustrate, use particular set of knowledge, demonstrate, determine, model, create a model for a particular thing, design an experiment, show that this whatsoever solution you have suggested, whether it's a best fit solution or not, will be getting fitted into evaluating and creating kind of model. That way, and then some sample questions, because automatic tethering of milking machine is used to milk and is attached to the udder of a cow. A milk dairy wants to automate the milking process. The milking process involves attaching the milking cups to the teats. Design a system for that, say. Now this, see, as you can understand from this question, this is a high level. Only those students will be able to attempt those questions if we will be able to align themselves with evaluating and creating level of Bloom's taxonomy. And they will obviously be able to answer these questions. They will be able to think of the possible answer of these questions if their teaching in the classes has also been of that particular level. If they have been given some examples in the classes where they have been asked to solve these kind of problems, only then they will be able to solve these problems first in the assessments and then later in the examination also. So these kind of question statements fit into the evaluating and creating level of Bloom's taxonomy. Now in the next few slides, I'll be showing you some questions and there will be repeated polls, and you will need to think, you will need to have a look at those questions and then reply in the poll that to which particular level of Bloom's taxonomy you think that this question is a best fit. And here we go with the first question. Okay, before that, okay, we'll go with this. The first question: recognize the level of this question. So Chandigarh Police Administration is, I would request the IT team to kindly enable the poll also. Chandigarh Police Administration is facing a major challenge of controlling the traffic at some crucial junctions. Suggest a solution so that problem can be resolved with a maximum budget of rupees 10,000 per junction only. Right, So which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question statement fits in? And it's a real life problem, and the students are expected to suggest a solution for Chandigarh Police Administration. See, if we ask, what I would like to say, if we ask these kind of questions in the question paper, you can feel, you can clearly understand how elated the students will be, that they'll be able to align, they will be able to think that they are learning a subject which has got some real life application. We are still getting answers, very good. As of now, 3% have told that it is the remembering level, okay. 9% say that it is 10% now, they say that it is the understand level. 28% of they say that it is the apply level. 51% say it is the 50% say it is analyze. 20% say it is evaluate. 16% say it is create. Okay. So the more of the bias is toward analyze and apply. Very good. If I have to answer this question, I would also like to put this question statement at either at analyze or apply. I would say why it is not remembered, because there is nothing to be remembered here, right? I gave you a typical example of what is the remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. I gave you a typical example. What is the energy band gap of silicon? Remember, 1.1 electron volt. Do you find anything related to that here in this question statement? No. So this question is definitely not the remembering level. Understanding gave you the example like whether they have understood a particular scenario. 13% said it is understanding. But what is exactly required is that they are simultaneously supposed to suggest a solution, and they will not be able to do that till the time they are not able to analyze the situation critically and then apply their knowledge. So my vote here would be more toward analyze and apply. And again, we always keep on discussing this thing. Means our team always keep on discussing this thing. That, see, teaching is more of a philosophy always. It is not so that whatsoever I say that it has to be analyzed only and that should be 100%. It is a kind of writing on the wall that it's analyzed only. We may always differ in our opinion. But more or less, this particular question should be aligning with analyze and apply on. Think again, and I'm sure you'll be able to understand it well. And that is the purpose of this particular poll questions as well. There are as many as 7-8 questions. And from there, you'll be able to understand that critically, and you'll be able to align your questions also that to which particular Bloom's taxonomy level your question fits in. And as I told in the beginning also, there is an assignment. There is going to be an assignment also where you'll be needing to set a question paper and you'll be needing to assign all your questions certain level of Bloom's taxonomy, right? So please understand, please do this polling. Please attempt this polling very, very carefully. Okay, we can close this poll, please. And we'll go to the next poll. Next poll is, please activate the next poll, please. It says 12A, 12A small size 2.0. You need to enable me to read this screen, at least one screen. So there is a requirement to 12A small size USB 2.0, 3.0 CMOS camera system, which can be used for industrial application, medical applications, microscopy, etc. The system should be able to capture the image quickly and be able to process the captured image and then store it also. Yeah, one complete minute for you to read this statement very carefully and then think of that to which particular level of Bloom's taxonomy this particular question statement fits in. Very good, very good, very good job. Extremely good participation also. read the statement again and then try to answer which particular level of Bloom's taxonomy this question fits in. Very good. Okay, so we can end this poll. People are still responding, but end the poll because we have more or less got the results. Very good. 68% of you said this is should pertain to create level of Bloom's taxonomy. 22% of you said it is evaluate. 17% said it is analyze. 24% said it is apply. 9% said it is understand. And 3% said it is remember. Right? I'm very sure we'll go with the majority. This question definitely fits in at the create and evaluate level of Bloom's taxonomy. So I already told you, one particular question statement always be fitting in somehow between two Bloom's taxonomy level, create and evaluate. This question statement is a classic example of create and evaluate levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Okay, we'll go to the next, please. Okay. We go to the next poll. Please activate the next poll, please. I need to see this screen. So there is a requirement to amplify the signals with amplitude levels as low as 1 millivolt falling in the frequency range of 10 hertz to 200 hertz. So amplifier is required to be designed and the signal amplitude has been given and simultaneously the frequency of the signal has also been given. Now, the question starts, what essential steps you'll be taking into consideration for the design of such a circuit block? It's not asking you to design. It is asking you to what steps you'll be taking into consideration for design of such a circuit block. Do you need any more piece of data to suggest the complete design? If yes, what other information you will need? Assume some typical values of your choice of all the missing parameters and then design a complete circuit which can do the needful. So there is not only one question, but there are multiple questions in this particular question statement. The statement starts like only two things have been given. One, the amplitude of the signal, and then the frequency range of the signal. Then it asks what kind of circuit block it would be. Do you need any more data? And then design the complete circuit block. Okay. Yep. Yes, the poll is on. Please go through the question very carefully and then assign these questions a particular level. So 50% of you say it is an analysis question. Very good. Yes. Part of the question because this question is divided into multiple parts. There are 2-3 questions in one question only. When it says what essential steps you will take into consideration for designing of such a circuit block, this is more of understanding. It is more of understanding. If the student has understood the subject well, then he would be able to suggest that what are the steps required to achieve this particular objective. But then it says simultaneously, do you need any more data? This is also understanding. Because if he has understood well, then he would be able to judge. He would be able to answer this also, that this is the missing piece of data. But then simultaneously, the last part of the question says, think of all the missing components and simultaneously design a complete circuit block. Now, when it says design a complete circuit block, it is definitely create. Without thinking through the whole design process, he will not be able to do this. And once this is required to be done, then it is definitely aligning with the create level of Bloom's taxonomy. So let's go on to the next poll question. Please activate next poll, please. To which level of, this is simple, right? Right to table and symbol for AND, OR, NOT, and XNOR logic gates. To which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question fits in best? Right to table and symbol for AND, OR, NOT, and XNOR logic gates. Now people, this question, I'm very sure the people from CSC background or ECE background would be able to understand very well. People from other backgrounds, like let's say mechanical or other background, who don't deal into these logic gates maybe very frequently, but still by reading this question statement, you should be able to understand that basically what is being asked is, their student is expected to write something and then draw something. Right? Student is supposed to write something and draw something. To which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question will be fitting in? Yeah, it's a simple question. It is definitely should fall in remember at the maximum understand, right? Why I say understand, we can close the poll, around 67% of you said that this is falling in the remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. I agree to that. But why I said that simultaneously, it may go to understand also, because logic gates at times are a little tricky. There is much more understanding beyond simply drawing the symbols as well. Although this question simply expects them to only write the truth table and draw the symbols, I would say my vote would go for the remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy for this particular question. Let's go to the next poll, please. So there is a question statement. In fact, this question statement was there in earlier also when I was giving the examples of different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Discuss the effect of Making India initiative on the Indian manufacturing industry. So to which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question fits in? And we are getting the answers very fast, very good. There is nothing much to be created, actually. We are not, so I'm sure you would be able to distinguish between now what is creation and what is remembering and what is understand. You remember one question which we did a couple of slides back, where we specifically asked the student to design a particular circuit block. That was creation, right? Here, what we are expecting the student is that he would have read well about Indian manufacturing industry. He would have read well about Making India initiative, then he's supposed to reflect his understanding about Making India initiative on the Indian manufacturing industry. He's supposed to reflect his understanding. So it is more of understanding level. Around 50% of you said that it is definitely getting aligned with the understanding level of Bloom's taxonomy, right? Okay, we go to the next poll question, please. To which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question best fits in now? Find out what will the electricity bill for an Indian household with its following consumption. So what we are supposed to do is, what the student is required to do, it's a kind of numerical statement. Electricity bill for an Indian household is required to be found out. And where a fan of 40 watt rating runs 5 hours a day, a CFL of 20 watt rating runs 4 hours a day, television with 100 watt rating runs 3 hours a day. A refrigerator with around 200 watt rating runs 20 hours a day. Assume that electricity is charged at rupees 10 per unit in that particular state. So which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question best fits in? It's remembering, it is understanding, it is applying. Is it analysis, it is evaluating, or it is creation? Think yourself. Are is the student expected to create anything as a final answer of this question? Answer is no, he's not creating anything. What he is supposed to do, what he is doing here, he is carrying out some kind of analysis, right? And then he's applying his knowledge. Some kind of analysis, evaluate, yes, partially evaluate. Many of you are saying that it's evaluate, yes. It may be evaluate. It's a kind of, it looks like a evaluate problem, evaluate problem statement. It looks like, definitely it looks like a more of evaluate problem statement. This is how it has been designed. But then what ultimately he's trying to do is, what the student is expected to do is, make some quick calculations and then find out the, finally the electricity bill for that household. So I would rate this question in apply and understand. Apply, more of apply and then understand. Why apply? Like he is supposed to remember a couple of formulas. He's supposed to apply a couple of formulas and then find out that what will be the electricity bill for this particular household, right? So more of apply, and that is what more of, most of you also agreed to that also. So I'm very glad that way, that maximum you are appreciating, maximum you are able to understand this thing as well. Identify your questions statements, the question statements with right level of proof taxonomy. And I repeat, it is not a writing on the wall that whatsoever is being told here, that particular question will be finally fitting in this particular level of proof taxonomy only. Your understanding and my understanding might be different. Your perception about a question, my perception about a question, or your colleague's perception about a particular question might be different. But the objective here is, the whole objective here is, we should be, with our best effort, we should be trying to set up a question paper with our best of the understanding, with best of ability, we should be able to set up a question paper which should assess all levels of Bloom's taxonomy. I repeat, with the best of our understanding, we should be able to set up a question paper which should be able to assess all levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Right? Okay. Last example, quick example. I have been talking about this example many number of times. So it should be cakewalk. What is the energy band gap of silicon at room temperature? To which level of Bloom's taxonomy this question best fits it? What is the energy band gap of silicon? I expect 100% correct answer, because this particular example I have given many number of times in today's session. So in total, we have taken 7 different examples. Last 7 slides, from slide number 25 to slide number 31. Last 7 slides were all showing different kinds of questions, and where you yourself aligned those questions with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And what is expected is that you should have a close look at all the question papers which you set for yourself, for your students, and try to align those questions with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And that's what the assignment is also going to be for you for tomorrow. As rightly guessed, I've been telling this in my earlier part of the session also, this question is easy to be put in very easily in the remember level of Bloom's taxonomy only. Right? I'm sure after this, could we close the poll, please? After this clear-cut distinction between different kind of questions of Bloom's taxonomy, let us spend some time on understanding that how different levels of questions or different levels of Bloom's taxonomy questions could be framed for a particular topic or for a particular subject only. Now, if I ask some questions related to Newton's laws of motion, how I can simultaneously raise the level of questions and I would be able to take the questions to the next levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Next couple of slides, we are going to talk more about that. If there is a question statement, write the Newton's law of motion. typical remembering level of Bloom's taxonomy. Discuss the Newton's law of motion, typical example of understanding level of Bloom's taxonomy. Derive the equation of motion of a rigid body subject to n forces. He has to apply his knowledge. He has to apply his knowledge to particularly this particular scenario. Derive the equation of motion of a rigid body subject to n forces. So it is applying. Derive the equation of motion of spring damper using Newton's laws. It is analyzing. He has to analyze a real life scenario and then derive this equation. Typically, analyzing level of Bloom's taxonomy. Now, Newton's laws of motion question can be taken to evaluating level also. How? The question is, a lifting mechanism is to be suggested to lift a load of 100 tons. Suggest a mechanism that is safe, cost-effective, and easy to operate. Now, when the student taught by you would be joining a top-notch company tomorrow, I'm very sure they'll be encountering these kind of real-life scenarios, real-life question statements, real-life problem statements also. Very important for us to train him to handle these kind of levels also. We need to be sure of that our questions asked in the question papers should not only be satisfying only a couple of levels, only remembering and understanding only. Our question papers should contain all levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Because this is what they are required to do when they would be going in field, going for the real life jobs. Creating, again, question related to Newton's laws only. Develop a system to lift 100 ton of load at a maximum acceleration of 0.5 meter per square second, the velocity not to exceed 1 meter per second, the mechanism should be safe, cost effective, and easy to operate. Definitely a question pertaining to creating level of Bloom's taxonomy. And all these questions, all these six questions which have been shown, are related to the basic, the fundamental is for Newton's laws of motion. Right. Let's take another example. And this question is for typical, say, electronic engineers. If I ask a question to the student, what is the unit of current? Ampere. Remembering level of question. I ask another question, which of the following will cause the current through an electric circuit to decrease? Choose all that apply. Decrease the voltage, decrease the resistance, increase the voltage, increase the resistance. So somehow his understanding about current is supposed to be tested. He needs to understand what is current basically. He doesn't need to, he obviously needs to remember what is the unit of current. So remembering is anyhow going to be tested. But if we ask this question like this, that we put him into a situation and we make him think, he would be able to answer that question only when he would have understood the concept of current. Then apply the knowledge about current. Compute the voltage drop across each resistor in the given circuit below, provided voltage and resistance value are given, right? So we make the question statement a little more elaborative. We provide him with the voltage and resistance, and we then expect him to calculate the voltage drop. So first question, we expect him to just remember the value of a unit of current. Second question, we put him into a situation and analyze and not analyze exactly, but understand, reflect his understanding part of the understanding part of the concepts about current. Third is apply his knowledge for a kind of circuit which has been shown to him. Then analyzing which of the given circuits will have higher value of current through resistance R3, given data voltage and resistance values in the figure given below. Then evaluating for the given electric circuit, draw an electric equivalent circuit diagram assuming DC supply of 12 volt and B1, B2, B3 of 2 ohms, 3 ohms and 4 ohms respectively. It should be actually R1, R2, R3. I'm sorry for the typo here. Calculate the power consumed by the circuit. So here the evaluating, he needs to evaluate the complete circuit and then accordingly find out the power which is going to be consumed by the circuit. Then in creating, using Ohm's law, construct a voltage divider circuit to obtain X voltage from a battery bank of Y voltage. So he needs to construct. And if you, again, the best way to align your questions is, There were around five to six slides in today's presentation as well. Same have been beautifully detailed in examination reforms booklet by AICT also. You can identify the particular terms. Like if there is a construct word, you can easily align that this question is definitely for creating level of Bloom's taxonomy. Let's go on to the next example. Again, a question more for the mechanical engineering background or the physics, basically it's a physics based question. What is a project type? He needs to understand, he needs to remember the definition of project type. Differentiate between trajectory and path, right? A ball is thrown horizontally with a speed of 120 kilometer per hour from a height of 1.181 meters. In how much time the ball will touch the ground, use standard formulas for all the calculations. And when this question, when we were framing this question for applying level of question, for applying level of Bloom's taxonomy, on the back of our mind, we're thinking that yes, we are supposed to design, we are supposed to design a bowling machine, cricket bowling machine. And then that is how the level of different questions have been raised, right? When a ball is being thrown by a bowler, we treat it as a projectile. Then he should understand the difference between trajectory and path. Then we are slowly raising the level of the question that a ball is thrown horizontally with a speed of 120 kilometer per hour and the bowler is say 1.81 meters tall. In how much time the ball will touch the ground, use standard formulas for all the calculations. So it is applying level of Bloom's taxonomy. Then a ball is thrown slightly raising the level of the question more. The ball is thrown horizontally with a speed of 120 kilometer per hour, with a height of 1.81 meters, in how much time the ball will touch the ground, use basic principles of science to reach on to the final results. While the in the applying level of question, it says use standard formulas for the all the calculations, means there must be some standard formulas which should be easily available. Just use those standard formulas to reach out to the final result. But when you have to use the basic principles of science, then it means you are simultaneously analyzing this real life scenario also. And this question should fit into the analyzing level of Bloom's taxonomy. Next is, again, raising the level of question more. A cricket academy recently procured a ball throwing machine with certain level of specification in terms of maximum speed, spin and swing also. Design an experiment to test the accuracy of the provided specifications. Assume standard values of providing your due suggestions. So what is being, so Cricket Academy recently procured a ball throwing machine and they gave some specifications that, okay, this bowling machine can ball at the maximum speed of say 140 kilometers per hour and it can swing the ball for with an angle of say 10 degree or so. What the student is expected to do is he needs to think of that how exactly if this machine is required to be tested, what kind of testing mechanism should be put in place. So it is evaluating. He first needs to evaluate the performance of the machine and accordingly think of a experiment, think of a situation that how the performance of this particular machine can be tested. And in the last, further raising the level of the question, design a cricket ball throwing machine which can ball to a batsman with controllable speed range of about 80 kilometer per hour to 140 kilometer per hour. Besides that, machine should be able to swing the ball to an extent of angle of 10 degree and spin to an extent of about 30 degree or so, right? Excellent example of creating kind of question only, where the student is supposed to come up with a complete design that this is how the bowling machine should be performing, should be able to ball at a speed of 80 kilometer per hour to 140 kilometer per hour, should be able to swing the ball with 10 degree of angle, should be able to spin the ball with an angle of around 30 degree or so. Then another example of different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. What is the unit of clock speed of a microprocessor? Hertz, we know that. Did I need to actually create anything? No. Did I need to actually understand anything about the same? No. I just need to remember that the unit of clock speed of a microprocessor is Hertz. Then next level is how many registers will be required to store around 100 megabytes of data when every single register is able to store around 8 kilobytes of data. So now here it is the understanding of the student which will be checked, right? Now whether it's going to be 100 megabytes divided by 8 kilobytes or how it is supposed to be done, right? How many registers will be required? The requirement is of 100 megabytes of data and every register can store 8 kilobytes of data. So how many registers will be required? Obviously his understanding of the subject will be required to be tested. Then third is how much time a computer machine will take to solve a mathematical problem with around 100,000 instructions to perform. Assume that machine is running using a microprocessor with a clock speed of 3.2 gigahertz, hard disk drive of 100 gigabytes memory capacity and random access memory of 6 gigabytes or so. Now again, this problem statement has been taken from a very, very real life scenario. And students' actual knowledge about applying his knowledge will be tested in this particular question. Then analyzing, in order to reduce the processing time of computer machine, reduce the number of logic gates in the given circuit. Again, analyzing. We know it very well that a good circuit, that circuit is a well-designed circuit which can be designed with lesser number of gates, right? The same thing has been asked here as well, that in order to reduce the processing time of a computer machine, we really want that the machine should be able to respond fast. We need to reduce the number of logic gates in the given circuit. So suggest a mechanism. So needs to analyze the complete scenario that how many logic gates have already been put in, which logic gates can be replaced, etc. Then this is the analyzing. Then evaluating, traffic police team of Chandigarh is in process of procurement of a smart traffic light controlling system with following specifications: 4 exit points, variable time for any particular color of traffic light display depending upon the traffic density. Suggest an experiment to test the proposed solution. Again, testing a proposed solution, as was told in the last slide also, when the performance of a bowling machine was supposed to be tested, it is more of the evaluating level of Bloom's taxonomy. And then it says, for a finite state machine, finally creating level of Bloom's taxonomy, design a counter which will undergo the following state, 014715. So finally, the student is expected to design a complete finite state, design a counter for a finite state machine, right? Now with all these examples, it is felt that you would be able to, the participants would be able to understand very well that which particular level of Bloom's taxonomy all the question statements fall in. Simultaneously with these examples shown in the last few slides, you'll be able to think of that how the level of question around the same topic, around the same course, around the same subject can be raised to different levels of Bloom's taxonomy. Right? Toward the end of the session, there are some very general suggestions for setting up good assessments. Review learning objectives of the course before setting up a question paper. This suggestion was discussed in more detail in the beginning of the session also, that it is every course must have course learning outcomes. Same way, every assessment should be aligned with the course learning outcomes. Very, very important. So instead of setting some random questions in the question paper, try to align your questions with course learning outcomes and definitely with the Bloom's taxonomy levels as well. That is what the focus of this whole session has been. While setting a question paper, again, test understanding, not speed. And the argument for the same is, no one has ever shown that someone who takes 20 minutes to solve a problem will make a better professional than someone who needs 35 minutes. In fact, people who are careful but slow often do better work than people who are quick but sloppy. So test understanding, not speed. If your examination pattern permits, maybe you can have lesser number of questions, but then test the understanding, not the speed. Use graphs, illustrations, pictures, and videos. If again the pattern of the question paper permits, try to make it the question paper more lively, have more number of diagrams, more illustrations, more graphs, instead of having only a monotonous question paper of say 1 to 2 pages long only, or having only some question statements only. No, make it more lively. Have some graphs, some illustration, some pictures of the scientists. Ask questions related to that. Likewise, I started the whole session by showing you the picture of Benjamin Bloom, so that you are able to relate well with this session. That from where this whole terminology has come in, right? Try to have some open-ended question statements. Again, if the examination pattern of your university, of your organization permits, try to have some open-ended questions. Please don't expect unique answers to every question. And that is how in real life as well, if there is a problem statement, if we come across a problem, then if there are 10 different wise minds, intelligent minds will be suggesting a solution to that particular problem, all 10 may suggest different solutions, and all those 10 solutions may be working solutions also to solve that problem. Because ultimately, the objective is we are supposed to train our students to solve real life problems. Same way, it's better that they should be trained during their graduation days only when they're appearing in their examinations. Try to have some open-ended question statements also. Then design tests to maximize learning. Students should feel like, right? I strongly feel that when student has appeared in that, say, 3 hours of examination or 4 hours of examination or 1.5 hours of examination, when he goes out of the examination hall, he feels like discussing it with his peers. This is how I attempted this question. How did you attempt this question? Right? Because if there are some standard answers to those questions, then there is hardly any scope. Everybody will be writing the same kind of script to those questions. No. Design test to maximize learning. Even after attempting the test as well, students should be in the awe of the question paper. Yes, after doing this question, I learned something also. After attempting the question paper also, I learned something more. Solve the test yourself before administering to students. Very, very important. Once you have set a question paper, very important that you must solve it yourself also. And the thumb rule here is usually the student would be taking around double of the time which you will be taking to attempt the whole question paper. And when I'm suggesting you to attempt that question paper, I'm suggesting you to solve the whole question paper, not in parts. Attempt the question paper with all the numerical figures which you have given so that there is no ambiguity. There should not be unrealistic numerical figures in the question paper, right? There should not be unrealistic values which set more of confusion when the student is attempting that question. So please solve the question paper yourself. Always work out a test from scratch. See, usually many times the approach which is followed is that once we have set up a question paper, perhaps we'll keep on recycling the same question paper year after year, right? With little bit of modification of paraphrasing or little bit modification of the numerical figures. No, the idea should be every time we should be setting up a new question paper, starting from the scratch. That way our knowledge of about the subject will also be increasing many, many fold. Set a variety of problem statements, right? The question paper should not be boring, should not be monotonous. Question paper should be having more of MCQs, true, false, fill in the blanks, short numerical problems, some figures, illustration, as I told in the earlier slide also, pictures of the scientists, etc. Some pictures of the real life scenarios also, show them some agriculture field, show them the picture of some cricket ground, show them the picture of some real life situation. Add those real life situations so that when they're attempting the question, they should feel elated that yes, they are solving, after attempting this particular course, they are solving some real life problems as well. Then be crystal clear with the instructions at the top of the question paper. When we set a question paper, we do have this option of giving some instructions. Please set your expectations very, very right. Right? That this is what is expected from the student when he is attempting the question, he or she is attempting the question. Be very, very clear with those instructions. Set your expectations very right through those instructions when you at the top of the question paper itself. Then design 10 to 15% of tests to discriminate between A-level and B-level performance of the students also. Dr. Arsana also talked about this thing in much detail yesterday as well. all three variety of students in the class should be addressed. All levels of Bloom's taxonomy must be addressed by setting up a question paper. Question paper should be more for testing what they should know, not for testing what they don't know, right? And here is the last, this is where, from where we started, that design your curricular experiences at all levels of Bloom's taxonomy, design and write COs to address higher levels, design the test at higher levels of taxonomy, write and share COs, write and share assessment and test objectives. I'm very sure if we'll be able to do it well, then we'll be able to set the question papers in a very, very right manner, in the expected manner, and we would be able to see big examination reforms in our respective institutes as well. Thank you very much. This was the last slide. And I would like to see if there are any questions, comments in the Q&A window. Yeah, if there are any questions, any kind of questions, you may kindly type in the question, Q&A, more than glad to take those questions. Yeah. Difference between evaluate and the analysis, please. Somebody has asked, could you please evaluate analysis? I'm very sure after attending this session, in the beginning, I'm very sure you must be feeling like that these levels are overlapping to extent. But after having a close look at different varieties of questions which were shown in the slides, which have been discussed, I'm sure you will be able to align your questions very, 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 very well. Please, one expectation after this session, please have a close look at the maybe the last question paper which you had set for yourself. Try to write, remembering this question is R. This question is U, this question is E, this question is C. When you would have done that, you would feel yourself feel very, very happy about that you would have understood this session well. And simultaneously, when you will be setting the next question paper for yourself, you would keep all these things in your mind, right? And together, obviously, as I told, that we will be able to set this mantra of examination reforms in this country in a big, big way, right? Thank you very much. With this next session would be taken by Professor Shivani Malhotra, and we'll be having around, it is 2 minutes past 12, so I've kept the time very well. We would be having around 10 minutes of bio break, you can say, and then please join back for another wonderful, wonderful session by my colleague, Professor Shivani Malhotra, sharp at 12:15 p.m. Thank you very much. So I would sign up and have a great day ahead and have a great next session also. Thank you very much for attending this session.
A very good afternoon, everyone. This is Dr. Shivani Malhotra from Chitkara University for the session 4 of examination reforms. The session 4 is on assessment planning and rubric. Well, I'll take you through the session outline. Initially, we'll discuss about the quiz responses that you gave yesterday, the recapitulation of what Dr. Rajneesh, Dr. Jadhav, and Dr. Mantri, right, presented in the three sessions, assessment planning, that is the assessment components, the methods, the tools, and the tasks. Those are required for planning an effective assessment in order to be mapped with the program outcomes. Some sample questions and the assessment templates that we'll be discussing, and the rubric that is required for the assessments. Well, regarding the quiz responses, first of all, thank you very much, everyone. We had phenomenal response from yesterday's quiz. Round about 96% of you give the right answer of what OBE stands for, Right. That means we all are very well aware of what is outcome-based education, right? What does it mean? So that means we are directly getting aligned towards the outcome-based education in our different programs. Regarding the question number two, what is the primary purpose of evaluating an OBE training system? Well, 50% of you approximately, you know, gave the right answer to it, that what exactly is the main purpose? It is to provide data towards the program improvement, right? While 32% of you gave the answer that it provides the criteria for teacher evaluation, though it is an indirect way, you know, of giving a teacher's evaluation. Right, but then this is not what OBE training system do. Then the third was establish an average for the grading standard. Around about 13% of you gave this answer, and I hope now everybody is aware of what exactly this OBE training system is meant for, to provide the data towards the program improvement eventually. Which these is not a characteristic of OBE. Definitely competitive examination is not a characteristic OBE, because what we assume is while we are making the students focus towards learning, we are making them to approach towards the end-term goals. And through the alternative assessments, we are evaluating them towards those learning outcomes. That means we are indirectly making them competitive for these exams, right? But then, yes, it is not a characteristic of OBE learning system. There was another question, right? And that was that at the last stage of OBE, what is that is being evaluated, or what is it that we are evaluating? And it was really, we were really happy to see that majority of you, right, gave the right answer of it. That is what we were expecting, whether the learning outcomes, they were achieved or not. Yes, with OBE, we definitely see for whether the learning outcomes for which a program was meant, whether they are successfully, effectively achieved by the students or not, right? And then we have the next question, the most important characteristic of an outcome statement, right? The most important characteristic of this outcome statement is that it is observable and measurable, right? Anything that is not measured is not the hallmark of its type. Right. So it becomes important to measure that in order to have a complete loop system, and thus to provide the feedback to the system for the further improvement in the process. Let me take you through the recap. Just one sec. Okay, so we are left with certain of these questions which were asked in yesterday's quiz. Which one is the correct flow of HOTS, that is high order thinking skills? So apply, analyze, evaluate, and create, right, is the right order for the HOT skills, right? Which one is not a part of the four pillars of OBE? I remember Dr. Jadhav very, seamlessly explained about the four pillars of OBE, that is designing down high expectations from the faculty and expanded opportunity for the advanced learners, right? Designing up is definitely not a part or is not amongst the four pillars of OBE. Okay, so let's have a recapitulation of what previous session experts talk about. We do understand that the assessments, right, they drive learning. The students, majorly, while it comes on to the learning of the students, how they learn, what they learn, they are driven by what type of assessments are we giving them? how we are evaluating them. And Bloom's taxonomy, as Dr. Rajneesh just now told in his session, right, that Bloom's taxonomy plays a very important role to check in the dimensions of the cognitive level, as well as the knowledge level of the students. So as Dr. Mantri told in her session, that we need to check for all Rahul, Riyas, and Ronaks in our class, you know, that we need to cater all type of students, for every student for us is a unique student, right? So in order to cater the need of different students, we do follow different pedagogies, teaching pedagogies, right? But there is one part, right, in the entire teaching learning process, which saw minimal reformation in the previous years, and that is examinations and assessment, right? So while we consider that every student is a unique student, right, then we should have different tools to even evaluate our students, right? So we should have different type of assessments for different type of courses, and thus catering to all type of students, and thus getting to know the capabilities that these students are exhibiting. So Dr. Jadhav in his presentation told you about how this OBE originated, right, from the Washington Accords origin in 1989, while it came into existence with six signatory bodies, you know, and all of them working towards OBE. And now we are on to 2021, if we'll see, right now we have 21 permanent members with 7 provisional members, everybody working towards OBE. NBA is the signatory body from India since 2014, right? And you know, and this membership, it gets renewed after every 6 years. So we got our renewal in 2020 until 2026. Right, we are the member of this Washington Accord. So all these 3 accords and 4 agreements, they all come under the umbrella of IEA, that is International Engineering Alliance. Right, so all the members, all the signatory bodies have to follow the graduate attributes given by the Washington Accord. So in India, right, if we see NBA, they came up with the term program outcomes, right? Defining all the graduate attributes, those are required by required to be demonstrated by the engineering students, right? Or by the different graduates. So amongst these 12 graduate attributes or the program outcomes, if we'll talk about, right? 5 of the outcomes, they contribute towards the knowledge skill development, while another 7, right, they contribute towards the professional skills. And it becomes really important if you need to measure the success of a program, right, that is the outcome of a program, right, it is important to measure that. And in order to measure that, right, what is the way is we need to align our assessments to these program outcomes. We see that for every course in a particular program, we have n number of courses, and every course, right, demonstrate its own course outcomes. So all course outcome collectively, they contribute towards like achieving the program outcomes. So if I want to map a course outcome to a program outcome, initially when everybody was trying to do, it was a little bit difficult thing, right? To understand as how to map them and thus successfully and effectively map the program outcomes to the course outcome achieved. Then AICTE came up with examination reform policy and coined 2 more terms, competency attainment and performance indicators. These competencies attained and performance indicators act as a bridge between the program outcome and the course outcome, thus aligning them seamlessly. Okay, now the question arises, what is the need for these competency attainment and, you know, performance indicators, right? We'll see the program outcomes. They are directly connected to the competencies those are required to be attained by a student in order to cover that program outcome. Now, those competencies, those are required to be exhibited by a graduate, right? Now, that graduate need to exhibit those performance indicators, right? At least which are measurable, right? Those performance indicator has to be measurable and are measured through assessments. And assessments, they are aligned to the course outcomes. So if we'll see in this entire chain, the course outcome that get aligned to program outcome through competencies attained and performance indicator. A program outcome can have multiple competencies attained, right? So in order to achieve one program outcome, a student has to demonstrate multiple competencies. And in order to achieve that competency, right, there can be multiple indicators which are required to be tested, right, in order to successfully demonstrate that competency. So what we have is one program outcome can have three or four competencies, and further, every competency can have multiple indicators, those are required to be measured, right? And in this way, we have successful assessment evaluation. In this way, the assessment, they play a significant role, right? Assessments can be in terms of midterms, end terms, project, demonstrations, right? And those assessments, they act as a tool to measure these indicators and thus making the outcomes achieved. In the second session that we had by Dr. Rajneesh, right? So he told you about the Bloom's taxonomy, how to use Bloom's taxonomy in order to measure the different levels, different capabilities, you know, that are exhibited by the students. So I'll just summarize it through this, you know, slide. And I have borrowed this slide from Dr. Rajneesh itself, right? So this slide beautifully says, what is the fact one? Fact one is what student learn is always less than from what we teach. That's the truth, right? Second fact is how much they learn is determined by their native background, background and course topic, motivation for taking the course, and match between the learning style and teaching style, right? There can be other factors associated to it, but this is the major ones that we are considering, right? Which really determine, right, how much they have learned. Fact three, we don't do much about their ability, background, motivation, or learning, right? Learning styles. But then where we can contribute? We can contribute to maximize student learning. What we have to do is we have to enhance our teaching ability, right? If teaching abilities are different, then assessment also have to be conducted at the different levels of learning. That's why it becomes most important to plan an assessment, right? So this is another beautiful slide, right? And how I interpret it is, when knowledge dimensions aligns with the cognitive dimension, real-time teaching learning environment is established, right? So we need to measure in both the dimensions, that is the cognitive process, as well as the knowledge dimension, right? So Bloom's taxonomy gave some beautiful verbs which helps the teaching fraternity, right, in putting the right question while they are assessing the students. I'll take a very simple example, you know. Suppose the cognitive level that I want to measure is remember, right? And what I want to measure is the fact, the basic element that the student has acquired. So I ask a very simple question, list primary and secondary colors, right? This question of listing primary and secondary colors is going to check the basic knowledge, the remembrance part of a student. And suppose on contrary, right, I want to check the hot skills, high order thinking skills, right? And I want to have a question on evaluate, where the student is supposed to make some sort of judgment, right? So in that case, and what I want to evaluate at the knowledge level is procedural, how to do something using some method, right? So suppose if I ask a question of judge the efficiency of a sampling technique, right? So it caters both the need, the cognitive process at the evaluate level and the knowledge dimension at the procedural level, right? So this is where we need to work on, right? Designing right questions with the right approach and the right time. Assessment planning and rubrics. Now we start with session 4, right, of examination reform. The objective of this particular session is to discuss the importance of assessment planning, right? How to plan an assessment, when to plan an assessment in such a way that OBE is implemented and the question paper, it really demonstrates the implementation of OBE. And it will be followed by the analysis, which will be based on Bloom's taxonomy, course outcomes, and performance indicators. So the outcome after the completion of the session, what we'll be capable of doing, that is, as a participant, what you will be able to do after this session, you will be able to design your own assessment plan for the course you teach. You will be able to design an appropriate question paper, and you'll be able to analyze it on the basis of Bloom's level, performance indicators, and the course outcomes. And finally, you'll be able to design a rubric for the assessment task you have designed. Okay, now let's come on this level, right? That states that an assessment is a link between the outcome and the improvement. See, outcome assessment is a method for determining whether the students have learned, have retained, and can apply what we have taught, right? So assessment plan has three major components: a statement of educational goals for which it is planned, multiple measures of achievement of that goals, right? That is the multiple tasks, the assessment criteria, the assessment tools, the assessment methods associated with it, and the use of the resulting information to improve the educational process. So the result of the outcome assessment are a part of the feedback loop in which faculty are provided with the information what they can use to improve both their teaching and student learning. This is the reason why assessment is such an integral and a sacred part of this entire process, right? Okay, now let's come to next thing. 21st century engineering graduates, right? What is expected from them? We'll see traditionally earlier, you know, down the lane, if I talk about some, say, 5 years before, right? What was required by an employer? Only the theoretical concept and right way where these theoretical concepts can be applied. This was what was expected from the graduates of engineering. But now, with the changing trend and the demand of the industry, industry needs a graduate to exhibit, apart from this theoretical concept and application, he should be able to solve the real-time problems. He should be exhibiting lifelong learning. He should exhibit technology leadership skills, right? He should exhibit professional attitude and the life skills, creativity and innovation. Though we imbibed all these things in our curriculum, we imbibed all these things by changing our teaching pedagogy, right? But then, have we ever tested our students for all these skills? What are required by an employer for these century graduates? Right. This is the time to change an area which found the minimal change. Right. And that is the reason why assessment planning is required. So assessment plan is a judicious selection of assessment component, assessment method for each component, assessment tool for selected methods, and the number of tasks or activities under each tool. Suggestive assessments plan should ideally propose and include the program guide at the curriculum design stage, right? So while you are making an assessment plan, while you are giving the weightage, you know, that should have a due approval at the time of your board of studies, right? Or from the academic council. Only then that can be included in a particular program. So please take due care of that. Then is, while you make a plan, it should be reviewed by the course coordinator before the start of session. I'll focus again on this point. Before the start of session, and it may be modified as per the need through the set of procedure and should be shared with the stakeholders, that is the students, right, well in advance. See, if the students are required to be tested for evolving skills, there is a need to upgrade the assessment plan and match the skills. So ultimately, if an assessment is planned religiously, the course outcome can be assessed accurately. And if the course outcomes are assessed accurately, it leads to the assessments of the program outcomes, and that assessment will be quite realistic. So the entire assessment strategy should revolve around it, right? So what we have to do is, there is always a missing link between the course assessment leading to a realistic program assessment, right? So that missing link is required to be covered. And how that can be covered? That can be covered through a planned assessment. Planning assessment is well and fine, right? There is another thing, that is scheduling assessment. So even if you schedule the assessment with right time and right testing items, you know, by sharing of guidelines and rubrics, right, it becomes equally important. Otherwise, the outcome that we'll achieve will always be compromised, you know, right? So the assessment schedule should be such that it is continuous in nature. Suppose your course is, say, a 15-week course or a 14-week course or a 13-week course, depending upon, right, your university guidelines or the university schedule that you have for a particular semester, right? Then the entire assessment plan should be equally distributed throughout the semester. It should be properly scheduled. While I say a proper scheduling, it means it should be continuously evaluated. The student should be continuously evaluated. It shouldn't be like that the student knows I'll be evaluated at the end of week 6 or at the end of week 12 and ultimately in the end term examination, right? So the entire learning process or the learning curve of the student will get confined to that particular time, right? He'll think of, okay, my exams are there somewhere around week 13. I'll start studying in week 12 because I know I have to appear only for one exam. That is an end term examination, or I have to appear for a sessional test, right? So in that way, one is, the faculty won't be able to give the proper feedback to the student in order to attain the learning outcomes that he is supposed to demonstrate, right? So in order to do so, scheduling, I told, is most important, right? Why is it so important? Suppose a wrong assessment here, I intend to say, is a wrong assessment tool selected, right? Say I select a demonstration or presentation in week 2, right? That assessment tool is not a right assessment tool for the beginner level students, right? So that is what wrong assessment means. To choose the right assessment means to choose the right assessment tool for evaluation. Maybe in the beginning, we can go for a quiz that is going to check the memorizing or the remembering and the understanding level of the students. And the faculty is supposed to give the feedback to the student so that he can improve upon that. A wrong assessment method at wrong time, scheduled at wrong time, will give a poor outcome. Certainly a wrong assessment at the right time will again give a poor outcome. A right assessment method chosen, right, but then scheduled at a wrong time will again give a poor outcome. A right assessment method for evaluating the students and scheduled at the right time is going to give the desired outcome, right? So the scheduling is an integral part of assessment planning. Right. So before you give any assessment, be that be as simple as a quiz, it should always be followed by some guidelines and the rubrics to make clear as what are we expecting from our students? What is he supposed to do? At times, it is not even clear to the students what is the expectation of a faculty from him. What is he supposed to do? He don't get to know where he went wrong. He should be continually told about what went wrong in his demonstrations, in his work, right? So there are certain assessment tools, right, that can be opted by the faculty at different time throughout the semesters. There can be formative assessments, there can be quizzes, there can be demonstration in the form of oral presentations, right? There can be examination. Those examination can be semester end examination, those can be mid semester test, right? Then the another important part is there has to be self-evaluation, peer evaluation, and co-evaluation imbibed in your evaluation too, in order to make it more holistic, right? And in order to provide a student an experiential learning. Okay. So it's the time. Let's have the responses on the chat box for what assessment tools or method do you use for assessment of your courses? Please write on the chat window the assessment methods or the tools you have been using for the courses you have been teaching. So I'm getting a lot of answers on the quizzes and assignments and Vivas, right? Then MCQs, quiz, exam tour, problem-based learning, very nice. Very prompt replies, tutorials. So majorities are the quizzes and the MCQs puzzles. Case study, good one. Role plays. Very nice. End semester examination, PPTs. Oh, great. Mini project, live project, assignments. Right. So your answers are covering almost all the assessment tools, right, that we are going to discuss. Great. I think we are going to stop here. Right. Let's go for another question. At least I'm clear with that each one of you, right, is aware with assessment tools and methods, right? So the question paper that we are thinking for today, right, will have some, a good template with a good sort of assessment tools. Now, there is another question, right? How often do you think the assessment should be carried out for a course? How often do you think the assessment should be carried out for a course? Weekly. Okay, see, frequently is not measurable, right? So, okay, weekly, monthly, within 5 to 7 days. Frequently at the end of the semester, 3 times in a semester, monthly. Okay, thank you very much for the responses. Right, we'll stop here. Okay, right. So to give a brief answer off to all those who say that an assessment should be carried out 3 times in a semester, right? In a semester, generally, we have, 3 teaching months, almost 3 teaching months, right? 12 to 13 weeks of teaching, right? Some good 2 weeks of assessments, right? So for me, that is just my perception, my personal viewpoint, right? An assessment can be as small as a crossword. An assessment can be as small as a, you know, an extempore group study, right? So you need to check for it, right? What is the right time for your course for an assessment to happen, right? Maybe you found that one of the course learning outcomes should have been achieved by this time or is required to be evaluated, right? Once we have taught to the students or once we have completed a portion of the course, the student should demonstrate that course learning or a course outcome, then there is a need for assessment, right? Because until and unless a student is going to demonstrate the course learning outcomes, right, he won't contribute towards the attainment of the program outcome. So what we feel is that when we say that an engineering graduate or any other graduate, right, should possess these abilities, right, should possess, should demonstrate these, you know, competencies, then we need to check for those competencies. And your course outcomes, they play a very important role in it. So while you design your course outcome, please check for, are they really measurable? Will you be able to test for them, right? Test your students for these course outcomes, right? So those course outcomes are going to drive you towards the assessment, the methods and the frequency. Okay, so let's move on to the next part. Assessment planning, right? So in India, we have seen majority of our courses, you know, the highest weightage is that of an end-term examination, right? The question paper that we see, right? A student gets a question paper, he's evaluated for it, right? And then we give a grades to him on the basis of that question paper, right? So today we'll talk about majorly about that. That a good examination paper, what it should consist of, it should have different difficulty levels in order to find out the different capabilities of students. And Bloom's taxonomy, it helps us in that case. It helps the faculty to set the assessment, which is pretty much balanced, testing the different skill levels amongst the students, right? Then the appropriate weightage should be accorded to the different cognitive levels. We have two types of cognitive levels. You know, the entire Bloom taxonomy six levels, they have been divided into two cognitive levels. One is the LOTS, low order thinking skills. Your remembering, understanding, and analyzing, right? It comes under low order thinking skills. And HOTS, right? Applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. These are high order thinking skills. And at times, you know, analyzing, it is, it comes under the low order thinking skills also, as well as under high order thinking skills also, while we need to evaluate them. The weightage of different cognitive level in the question paper can vary from course to course. You know, it can't be like one shoe size fit to all, right? Every course has a different demand. So every course will have a different assessment plan, will have different assessment tools. And similarly, the weightage of different cognitive levels is going to vary from course to course. You can't fix it for all the courses and can't have a standard plan for all the courses of a program. Now, the pattern of the assessment in each course in, say, any engineering program, you know, we are supposed to align the assessment questions with the course outcome. That is the first step that is required to do. All the assessment questions, right, those are being asked, they should be aligned with the course outcome. And it should be verified that the learning outcomes of the course are tested and mapped. Sometimes, you know, what happens that some learning outcomes, they get over-tested, right, at the stake of the others, right, at the expense of the other course outcomes. So this should be avoided. And you will get to know when you will be mapping all the questions with the course outcomes. And that way you can redesign the question in the assessment. So it is recommended that any institution or university must set a threshold level, you know, for the LOTS. Low order skill testing questions. And generally we prefer that 40% of the weightage should be given to it. So overall weightage in the assessment to each Bloom's level, right? That is what we are to check for. Okay, so this thing we have already covered, that you know, normally first four learning levels, that is your remembering, understanding, analyzing, you know, and applying, they are addressed in terms of continuous internal evaluation and by semester and term examination. So all these four levels of Bloom's, right, they get tested through CIE or SAE, that is the interim examination or the continuous internal examination. But then there are abilities, ability to create, ability to judge through evaluation, ability to analyze something and then can apply to apply for real-time problems. You know, those abilities, they can be tested through a course project, through problem-based learning, through mini projects, through minor projects, through the case studies, you know, through the internship experience and the field visit. So it is not always important that all the question paper will contain all the six levels of Bloom's, right? So from course to course, if a course has a component of course project, or if course has a component of a case study, then those level, hot levels can be evaluated through those case studies, right, or through those minors or the capstone projects. Okay, so we have a poll for you. The first poll is, you will just see it on your screen. What is the percentage that is assigned to continuous evaluation internal examination for a project course? What percentage is assigned to continuous internal evaluation for a project course? We'll give you 1 minute to reply this answer. The poll is going to end within next 2 seconds. Oh, there we are. Right. We have around about 600 votes, right? Out of which 50%, exactly 50% says below 60%, right? And then another states up to 70%, 80%, above 80%. Okay. Right. See, I'll give you the answer to it, right? For all those who says above 80%, right? That means they are looking to evaluate higher order thinking skills through the project course. A project course, I just told, you know, in the previous slide, right? If we are to evaluate the high order, you know, thinking skills in the students, that can be done through project courses, right, or the industrial training. I'll give the answer to this question. Let me have another poll, right? How many of you think that the percentage is, what percentage is assigned to CIE, that is continuous internal evaluation, for an industrial training? Okay, so we end the poll. Can we end the poll, please? So you'll get a clear answer from this. See, a continuous internal evaluation weightage is what is defined by these blue boxes. And semester end term examination, right, or evaluation, you may take it, right, is defined by the orange boxes, right? And if you will see, the sum of these two comes out to be 100%. And then you have a bar which states movement from LOT, that is low order thinking skills, to HOT, high order thinking skills. In order to evaluate high order thinking skills, the weightage of continuous internal evaluation should be more. More it is, right, then the better way you will be evaluating high order thinking skills. So projects and the industrial experience, what we talked about was, what they need is, they need the continuous evaluation if you really want students to meet the program outcomes, right? If you want the student to meet that course learning outcomes, right? You need to evaluate the student at every stage of the project. It can't be like you gave him a statement, right? And you asked him, okay, you come after 3 months, and at the time of end term examination, you show me your project if it is working or not. Right? Or what did you do in the entire tenure to develop that project? You need to check for at every development stage, because your feedback is also an integral part of your assessment. Until and unless you are not going to provide the continuous feedback to the student, he is not going to improvise. Suppose ultimately in the end, right, if he delivers a project and then you realize, okay, this project needs this feedback. If this should have been done in this particular project, it would have come out to be a better version of it, an improvised version of it. But then that feedback is of no use, because this semester has already concluded. Student has already given the end term examination. He's already being evaluated for that. And he's definitely not gonna work for it, right? Because remember, in case of student, it is the assessment that drives learning in students, right? So once you give the feedback in the beginning, he'll definitely improvise on it. And if he don't do it, he know he won't be graded for it, right? So if you want to evaluate for high order thinking skills, then the component of the internal continuous evaluation, right, has a better edge, is higher in comparison to semester end term examination, because it has to be split ultimately to contribute towards the successful completion of the project or the training at the end of the semester. Okay, let's see the OBE assessment methods, right? In OBE, we have three types of assessment methods: assessment through examination, right, assessment through submissions, and there is another indirect method of assessment, that is assessment through feedback, right? So in case of assessment through examination, the different tools that we use for this assessment method is, it can be a midterm examination, it can be a class test, it can be a quiz, it can be an end term examination, and the last dot we have kept for you to fill, right? Because a faculty can think innovatively what tools you want to use for assessing your students, right? Then again, this assessment method can be, the students can be assessed by using the tools, right? Tools of submission, in which, you know, you don't give them a stipulated time period of certain hours, right? That time period is in terms of the submission timelines, right? Those can be weeks, right? As per weeks, those can be as long as months. So in the submission, the tools that you're going to use for the assessment is assignments, projects, case studies, and technical reports. And in indirect method of assessment, what we use is the feedback. The feedback about the CO attainment, about the PO attainment, the feedback from the stakeholders to further improvise this entire process, right? So these are the assessment tools that are used in OBE assessment methods, both in direct method of assessment and indirect method of assessment. We have another poll for you now, right? Which assessment method is more capable of assessing higher order thinking skills, right? So we have shared the three methods with you, right? The assessment methods of OBE. Which one of you think okay, good. The responses are coming. We have round about 300 responses in 15 seconds. So we have quotes from round about almost 70% of the participants, and let's end the poll. Right. So it's equilikely. 38% of you says that examination is a better method, for higher order thinking skills. 43% of you says submission is a better method, and 37% of you says feedback is a better method for, assessing the higher order thinking skills, right? See, higher order thinking skills can be assessed through examinations, submissions, and feedback, but then preferably is submissions, right? In order to, evaluate the higher order thinking skills in the students, you need to give them the time of that critical thinking also. You need to give them time to understand the problem, to analyze, to apply what they have studied, and then to propose a result for that, and then to propose a solution for that. So submissions are considered to be the best method, right, for assessing higher order thinking skills. Higher order thinking skills, you cannot effectively, I can't say that you cannot evaluate, but then effective evaluation of higher order thinking skills cannot be done in an examination of say 60 minutes or examination of 3 hours, right? So it has to be continuous, right? It has to be, you have to give the students the time to apply to that. That is the thing. Okay, let's come on to the assessment plan, right? And this is what you are supposed to do. Please see to it very carefully, because we have one assignment for you in which you have to come up with an assessment plan followed by a sample model question paper, right? On the basis of this assessment plan. So in the beginning of the semester, while the teaching part of the semester has not yet started, your assessment planning should start much before the start of the semester, much before the start of teaching, right? So your assessment plan would include all the tools, all the components. They can be graded, they can be non-graded, right? Now, they can be quantity driven, they can be quality driven, right? So the various tools that can be used, this is just a sample that I have taken for this sample assessment plan template, right? You can use any other tools too, right? I again repeat, this is just a sample. So the tools used here for the assessment of a particular course, right? First part is defining the tools that will be used for assessing the students. So here the tools defined for a particular course are assignments, midterm test, quizzes, one field work, and one end term examination, out of which all are graded except for quiz, right? That quiz is for the purpose of the feedback, right? That quiz is to reflect the student as which capability, right, he is, or you know, which competency he is required to exhibit and how much he falls short of that, right? So there can be ungraded assessment tools also, which can be used for the feedback purpose. That can be non-graded too. So we'll see to it, 100% of the weightage is through assessment, midterm, fieldwork, and end-term examination. Then the part B of the plan, this is where you have declared the tools, declared the frequency, that is the task, and declared the weightage of those respective tools. Now is your part B is CO. For every course, you have defined COs, that is the course outcomes, that after the completion of the course, what the student will be able to do, or what he'll be capable to demonstrating, or which competency he'll be possessing. So any course can have ideally between 4 to 6 course outcomes, right? So you need to define the weightage of each and every course outcome. Please make sure what you define, you test the student exactly for that weightage, right? If not exactly, approximately for the same weightage, otherwise what happens at the time the students feel cheated, right? What the template showed, we were not tested or evaluated for the same. As in this case, you know, course outcome 3 has a weightage of 30%. So student will be devoting a lot of time, a lot of strength, right, in order to attain this course outcome, because he knows the weightage of it is 30%. So while you are evaluating him, right, so even in your assessments, 30% weightage of this course outcome should be exhibited. If not 30%, approximately 30%. Say anything between 27 to 33%. Now is what we have done is we have merged the two. Part C give the merger of plan of part A and part B. And the COs are there with their weightage, and the weightage is 100% for a particular course. And then all the assessment tools that we have taken, in our case, we took the assignments, we took the midterm test, we took the field work and the end term examination, they are taken. Now the mapping is required to be done while you are framing, right, a particular assessment, while you're framing a particular assessment tool for them, right? So this is it. So for any sample course, this is the assessment plan that has been taken, right? That the assignment 1 will include what? Will include the testing of CO 1 and 2. Similarly, the assignment 2 will include the testing of CO 3, CO 4, and CO 5. And ST1 again will have the testing of CO 1 and 2. Right. And similarly, ST2 and the quiz and the end term examination. Right. What exactly will have testing of the COs, which particular CO? This should be very much clear and priorly defined. Right. So I'm getting some like on the chat window, there is some network issue. Right. Am I rightly audible to you all? Can I have a couple of people writing on the chat window? So we can move ahead. Yes, we get majority of yes here. I think, sir, there is some network issue at your end, right? Please check it. Thank you very much, everyone, for such a prompt reply, right? So let's move back to the session. Okay, so here you can see both horizontally and vertically, right? We have mapped at 100% mapping, 100% weightage of all the assignment contributing towards a particular course, and 100% of all the COs, right, for that particular course, right? Here we have another course, right? I borrowed this course from CSC people, right? This is a course of algorithm and computing system. They have defined their COs, please make sure you define your CO very clearly, right? You must define what you want your student to demonstrate, what you want him to exhibit, and should genuinely give what weightage is particularly required for that particular course, right? And then after giving this, choose, in our previous case, we didn't had any project work, right? In this subject, because this is algorithm and computing system, and if you see carefully to CO3 and CO4, right? So it will lead student to the higher order thinking skills. To develop and curate the artifacts that evidence acquisition of professionally relevant skills and knowledge, and the ability to apply computational thinking to generate solution. So here we are on to a level of creation, create the highest level of the Bloom's taxonomy. Similarly, we can see for CO4, identify and characterize the role of the discipline-specific knowledge and skill, right? Include the problem solving, critical thinking in the computational context, right? For the professional activities of the computer scientist, right? So in this case, the faculty decided to have a project work in order to evaluate CO3 and CO4 effectively, right? Because they correspond towards the higher order thinking skills, right? So faculty knew that from the, those quizzes and semester end examination and, the sessional test, right? We won't be able to effectively evaluate those higher order thinking skills. So a project work was given to the students, right? And they were evaluated for that. And there was a weightage of 20% in the entire course for this particular component. So these decisions are going to vary from course to course and faculty to faculty. But I repeat again, they have to be peer reviewed, right? Get them reviewed through the expert, right? And please implement the feedback what you get after the discussion with the experts and the peer members, right? So any change in the evaluation pattern, right, has to be declared at the time of your academic councils, right, or board of studies meeting. You should have a due approval of that. It shouldn't be like you started a course, in the mid of the course, you felt, okay, this course can have an internal component of 30% and external of 70% and I need to change it. No, that is not an appropriate way. That's why we say planning assessment, scheduling assessment is an integral part and is really sacred, right? Because there are certain revisions and due approvals associated with them. Okay, so let's move on to actually the template in an elaborated way for a single task, right? So ultimately what we were doing earlier was to decide the tools, right? Now in a particular tool, say you have five tasks, say a five assignments or two semester term examination and one end term examination. So there should be a template that should define that particular task in all respects, right? So first of all, what is that assessment method for which you are assessing the students? Whether it is an examination, whether it is an assignment, is it a project or it is a report? You need to declare that, okay? Which assessment method are you using, right? Which type of assessment is it? Is it a continuous evaluation, continuous internal evaluation, right? Or semester end examination evaluation. Then the nature of that. Nature means what is the requirement of that assessment, whether that assessment requires the solution from some mathematical problem, right, from the class materials, or it requires the students to visit the community, or it requires students to identify the problems from an ecosystem, right? What is the requirement? What is the nature of that assessment? That must be clear. And the time that is, the student should be bound to, whether it's a 2-hour written assessment, whether it is half an hour quiz, right? Whether it is a 1-week assignment, whether it is a 2-week case study, or whether is it a semester long project work. Right? You need to declare that in advance. Then what is the objective of the task? That should be very clearly cited, you know, in order to make a student effectively do what you want him to do. So describe an objective. What is the objective of the task that you are giving? And what is expected from the students, right? So the instructions should be very clear as what you are expecting to the students, what you want him to do while he's attempting that task, what he should follow. The weightage should be exactly same as you mentioned in your plan, right? If you mentioned a weightage for an assignment to be 10%, it should be 10%. It shouldn't be like it is a 5% weightage now. The weightage has dropped down, or you increase the weightage to 15%. No. Then the important part of it, and please take due care of it, that is question map. You design a question, you write a question, you map it to the course outcome, right? That question is testing which particular course outcome. Then Bloom's taxonomy level, right? That this question is aligned to which particular level of the Bloom's taxonomy. Performance indicator, right? That is the thing that Dr. Jadhav has very rightly explained to you. You know, with every program outcome, we have an associated competency. And with every competency, we have an associated performance indicator. So that performance indicator is required to be written here, right? That we are testing the student for which particular performance indicator, which performance indicator indicates, right, the performance of the students through the question that we are asking in the question paper and the marks associated with it. That is the graded version, right? So an assessment is incomplete without a rubric. A rubric defines clearly the expectations from a student, what he is tested for, what he is supposed to reply, and how he will be evaluated. So all these things, all these questions, they get clear with the assessment rubric, right? So we must specify a rubric along with the question paper. Then is feedback. Generally, we say within 10 days of what student has submitted you, you should be able to deliver the feedback to the student, right, regarding his submissions, right? But nowadays, I say even this 10 days is a long time, right? So while we have continuous evaluation, it should be within a week's time, right, after the submission deadline or the timeline. And you know, if the student submits you before timeline, right, then that he should be priorly evaluated. So that if you think the learning outcomes is required to be mapped more properly, or is required to be attained more properly, or there is some improvement required in that particular task which he has submitted, or the assignment or the project that he has submitted before the timeline, it should be returned to him with the same feedback. Submissions, please specify the date and the mode of conduct, right? And do not change the mode of conduct and the date of the timeline until and unless, right, you think that there is a dire need for it, right? So that will help in keeping our student fixed to the timelines, right? And they'll consider the timelines more seriously. And ultimately in the end, right, the task analysis and the remarks. The task analysis is what part of the question paper, right? Like how many questions, right, are of which particular level of Bloom's, are aligned to which Bloom's level, what is the percentage of that? That is going to help. That task analysis is going to help you to make a balanced assessment task, right? So that is why it is so important. And while it is graphical, it becomes easier for us to interpret that. Your semester end examination, we know, is an integral component of the assessment method to assess the learning. That is what we talked about, our question paper, right? Student learning anyway is not driven by the assessment. Thus, the question asked in the paper should evaluate higher order thinking skills and the abilities too, right? The structure and the quality has to be considered simultaneously, you know, while setting a question paper, right? So alignment of question with the relative COs to ensure that all the COs are effectively tested. This is what the summary of it, right? What, you know, we did in the last previous slides. So I've just summarized that in the slides. The number of testing items and the question that can vary to suit your course outcomes, right? Bloom's taxonomy level and the performance indicators. And choice, if any way, is required to be given, right? So while giving the choice, please make sure that you give the choice of the same COs, questions, you know, aligned to the same COs and the same Bloom's taxonomy level, right? This is what is most important. So assessment questions to map with COBT and PI, that is what our structure talk about, and all possibility difficulty levels, right? They should be catered in our questions. And, you know, in order to involve high order thinking skills, we can have, you know, open book test, self-learning courses, or, you know, MOOC courses, right? So those type of courses, they orient more towards the high order thinking involvement. Okay, so let's come to the next part of it, right? An example, right? Here in this case, I have taken just an example to show, right? So nowhere in this case, we say, okay, this is the most appropriate sample question, right? This is just a generic question, sample question that we have taken, right? From one of the basic courses, that is basic of electronics, right? So see, what we are testing is, we are only testing the understanding and remembering level of the student, right? So state whether true or false, the conductivity of silicon is always less than that of the germanium at room temperature. Don't focus on the words, right? Some of you definitely may be from the electronics and communication engineering background, right? But then it is just a simple question. State true and false can be in any of, you know, the question papers, right? So in this case, you'll see the Bloom's level that we are testing is only remembering, right? Because what they have to check is, they just have to check the conductivity, right? The conductivity of which of the two materials is higher or lesser, right? So the remembering skills that we are seeing, right? And the performance indicator associated with it is, we have written 1.3.1. Let me take you to the nomenclature of it. What does it mean? 1.3.1. The performance indicator nomenclature in itself tells you the entire thing, to which PO it is oriented, which competency, right, with that PO is aligned, and in that particular competency, which performance indicator are we talking about? So while we have PI1, that first digit tells you about the PO. So that means this is an indicator of PO1. 0.3, that second digit tell you about the competency, that is CA3, competency 1, competency 2, competency 3, right? So that means that program outcome, that first program outcome have 3 competency, and out of this, third competency is what we are catering. 0.1, in third competency, first indicator, that is what is inclined to this question, right? So PI 1.3.1. Now it will be more clear to you, right, if we'll go with example 2. So example 2 states, compare BJT and GFET on the basis of the following parameters, right? The parameters are already defined to students, that they are supposed to compare these two transistors on the basis of these defined parameters, right? So it is checking the Bloom's level understanding, just Bloom level understanding, right? But if you will see, it is inclined to performance indicator 2.1.2. So I told you, first digit tells a performance indicator 2, that is program outcome 2. So here you can see we have written program outcome 2, that is problem analysis. Identify, formulate, research literature, and analyze complex engineering problems, reaching sustained conclusions using first principle of mathematics, natural science, and engineering sciences. See, as a as a faculty, if I'll try to align this question to PO2 directly, right, it is very difficult for me to check for whether it is aligned to only this PO or to some other PO, right? Then let us see what the competency 2 talks about. Now, this problem analysis, that is program outcome 2, has been split into different competencies, right? The competency which matches with this question is demonstrate an ability to identify and formulate complex engineering problems. Still, if I see at a second filter stage also, it is difficult to me to orient, you know, this particular competency to this particular question. I'm not sure about it, right? Now, I'll come up to like performance indicator, right? If we'll check the performance indicator 2.1.2, identify engineering system, variables, and parameters to solve the problem. Now I'm very much clear ki yes, my question is like aligned to this performance indicator, right? Because what we are doing is, right, in this case, we are identifying these parameters in an engineering system, right, to solve this particular problem. Right. So it gets aligned to PA 2.1.2. And thus I can say that CO2 is mapped with PO2. So that's why we say that competency attained and performance indicator, they act as a bridge between COs and PO alignment. They makes the alignment easier. Right. So I'll explain it to you again. What you have to do is, while you have any question, right, in that question, you need to see to which performance, like program outcome, that particular question is getting mapped to, right? You're not going to check with CO because you have already aligned it with a CO, right? How to check a question, it is aligned to which particular PO, right? It is mapped to which particular PO. Check for the performance indicator. Right, because the performance indicator is the nearest entity, right, is the most simplified version, is the most split version of your PO. If your question get mapped with a performance indicator, right, you get the mapping of program outcome automatically, because the performance indicator in itself, right, states we have to go back and check for the competency. Right? Are we really looking for this competency? Right? And then check for the outcome. Okay, this is that program outcome, right? That this question is asking a student to demonstrate, right? So this is, we'll have another example to it. Okay. Now another simple question we have, right? So in this case also, I'll take the B portion. Right. So what it is doing is Bloom's level L5, right, evaluating. In this case, semiconductor says germanium and silicon, we know they play a very important role in the construction of every discrete solid state devices, right? We ask the student to choose silicon, germanium, and gallium arsenide, you know, a leading semiconductor for manufacturing electronic device, right, or the component, and we ask him to defend his answer. Why is he choosing any one of these, right? So obviously he has to analyze it. He has to evaluate, right? Why does he think that he is going to choose this particular material for manufacturing any electronic components he thinks? So there are a lot of assumptions, right? Those are associated in this particular question, right? Now is how to map this question to a particular program outcome. So we'll check first of all the indicator, right? So we have these four indicators. One is reframe complex into interconnected subproblem, identify, assemble, and evaluate information resource, ठीक है, आइडेंटिफाई एग्जिस्टिंग प्रोसेस सॉल्यूशन फॉर सॉल्विंग द प्रॉब्लम इंक्लूडिंग फॉर्मल जस्टिफाइड अप्रोक्सीमेशंस एंड अजम्पशंस, कंपेयर एंड कॉन्ट्रास्ट ऑल्टरनेटिव सॉल्यूशन प्रोसेसेस टू सिलेक्ट द बेस्ट प्रोसेस, राइट? सो दिस performance indicator in itself states, right, that this is very closely related to that part B, right? So we have PI 2.2.4 associated with question number 2 part B, right? So it states program outcome 2, competency 2 and indicator 4, right? They are connected to this particular question. Okay, so there are a couple of questions coming out regarding the assignments, right? So regarding the assignment, here what I want to talk to everyone is that you have a timeline till tomorrow, right? So even if you want to submit the assignment, yesterday's assignment and what we are going to give you today, right? Please post them on the same link as was mailed to you yesterday, right? So there is another question, see. So this question we have borrowed from mechatronics people. Don't go on the wording of the question, right? They have just taken a measurement model for a mobile bot, right? And it is being ruled by some equation, right? That equation is VAB plus B, right? Where they have declared all the parameters in this case, and they have given a scenario, right? That in an experiment, they tested for that if the voltage, if the velocity is say 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, 50, what will be the relevant voltage at that time, right? Which is measured for fixed ground truth velocity as there. So now they have given a scenario that the velocity is required to be reduced by an amount of last two digits of their roll number. Now see, same question becomes a unique question for all the students, right? So it's a different question now, right? So estimate the voltage for this particular speed, upload the code and screen and screenshot for the result. So in this case, the level analyzing, right? So applying and analyzing. So there are some certain set of rules, right? They are to apply to check for the extremities, then they are to analyze, right? Depending upon the digits of the roll number they have taken and by which they have reduced the velocity, what will be the value of the voltage and thus give their result, right? So both the Bloom's levels, they are, catered by this particular question. And if you can see to it, right, in this case, performance indicator 1.1.1, 2.4.1, 4.1.3 and 5.1.3 are catered through it, right? So we have a examination reform policy booklet, right, by AICT, and that is already there on the web link too. If you'll see to it, right, they have given the program outcomes for almost all the engineering programs. Only the program outcomes for computer science and engineering are different, right? So they have basic program outcomes for all the engineering programs. And thus, with those program outcomes, they have also mentioned the competencies and the indicators, right? So you can check the performance indicators from there while framing your own question paper. So similarly, these are some certain examples, right? So for the Zener diode, right, we have seen, we have given in the sample question paper, please pay attention not on the performance indicator alone in this paper, right, in the sample question that we have taken. You are to design your own model question paper or a sample question paper for the course that you are teaching. Right. So in that you can have, you may follow the pattern that is defined by your university. You may have 5 questions, 10 questions, but then those questions, right, should cater the entire course outcome. Please ensure that, right? So what you are to do is you are to prepare the questions for that particular course. give them the marks, the grading that you want, that every question should be defined by the marks, right, of how many marks the question is. Please align it to the course outcome of your course. Then the Bloom's level that you think that question is best fit for, right? And the performance indicators, right? For the performance indicators, please check the policy document of the examination reforms, right? And do it, right? So this will be an assignment that you have to submit till tomorrow. And in tomorrow's session, right, if you'll get a chance, right, or you are selected and you'll be willing to present your question paper, it will be discussed with the experts, right? So the appropriate feedback will be given to the faculty as what is required to be improved in that particular model question paper or a sample question paper. Right, so this is the template for that. Right, you have questions, you have marks, you have to align them to the COs, align them to the performance indicators, align them to the Bloom's level, right, and then to the time that is required to like do that question. Do you think what time the students will take to do that question? Okay, now what else? That model question paper is one thing. How will we get to know whether our question paper is balanced or not, right? Please make a check of it, right? And how you are to do it. All the Bloom's level, right? Identify the question which corresponds to which particular Bloom's level, right? Write the question number and the marks associated with it. It is going to give you a clear percentage of, right? See, until unless you're going to do this, you won't get to know whether your question paper is balanced or not. This is what a graphical analysis, it is going to give you a clear picture of, right? At what level of balancing are you there in terms of question paper setting? Maybe you need to do a little bit of retweeting, right? Then do it. No worries at all. And please make sure that understanding and remembering, right, collaboratively, take a collectively, cumulatively, right? They makes a percentage of 40%, not more than that, means approximately 40%. It may be 44%, it may be, you know, 35%, right? You need to check for that, right? And it may vary from subject to subject, I repeat again, right? It may be possible and in case of certain subject, you don't have a creating level, right? Or the percentage of that level of creating and evaluating is, you know, the minimal one, right? That can happen, right? Because these are the higher order thinking skills. Okay, the second analysis that we are supposed to do is CO distribution, right? So first of all, we are to ensure that all COs are mapped with the test items we have, right? In our tool we selected, right? Test items means the questions that we are having, right? So all the COs are tested by the means of the questions that you are putting in the question paper, right? And then please write the marks. Every CO, like every question is contributing towards the testing of the COs, and check for the weightage of it. And please make sure that the plan that you made in the beginning, right? The plan that gave what percentage of the CO, right, will hold the weightage while you are testing during the assessments, right? That should be approximately same. While we say approximately same, it means ki suppose CO1 in your plan, you mark to be 15%, right? So that CO1 is 15%. And here you have a weightage of marks 14%, right? So it is almost same. Say CO2 was 40% there, right? And here it is 42%. It is absolutely okay. But it shouldn't be like there you are saying in the plan document, you talk that the CO will be evaluated for 40% weightages hold in evaluation, right? And here in the question paper, the questions that are testing the CO2, right, has a weightage of only 25%, right? So that is what we are to ensure through these analytics tools. Right, these are the associated performance indicators, right? You are to very rightly check for that. Somebody was writing on the chat window, what about the performance indicators? We do have to map for the performance indicators, right? That in testing all the COs, which performance indicators are tested, because ultimately they give the testing of the POs as such. Another important thing, in examination plan is rubric, right? So if we don't have a rubric with us, right, we are not gonna, we won't be effectively declaring as what we are expecting from our students. So what is a rubric, you know? So rubrics are the tools, these are used for grading the student performance and learning for a set criteria and objective. Right. So performance criteria are the expectations and the descriptions that are given in the rubrics, right? That tells us like possibly the achievement of the students, right? So rubrics should be communicated to the students for all sort of assessment tools that you are selecting. The rubrics can be a checklist rubric, it can be a rating rubric, it can be a holistic rubric, it can be an analytic rubric. Right, but we must be clear of where to use which type of rubric, right? So all these rubrics, they may be used for all sort of assessment tools, right? For seminars, for project, for case studies, for trainings, for internships, right? And say even for the POCO feedbacks. Now, there comes a question is, can we design a rubric for conventional examination questions, right? Yes. Right, we can make rubric for any assessment tool, right, which we expose to the student for which he is tested. Now, this one is a checklist rubric. You know, it is a simple checklist, right, which is indicating the presence of the thing for you. So you just need to put a tick or a cross. You get to know, okay, ultimately in the end, it is going to give you analytics of what are we short of. What are we supposed to do? Like in this case, we have assessment method. Say this is for any faculty while you are planning for your particular course, right? So whether you have assessment method specified, whether you have assessment nature specified, whether the objective of the task is specified, whether the expected student output is specified, weightage is in line with the assessment plan, rubric is defined, feedback mechanism explained, okay, matching of 40:60 ratio for the lots and hots is maintained, or the task analysis is acceptable or not, right? So why are they important? You know, it is these type of checklist rubric, right? They are important, right? To set the priorities, you know, we know nowadays we are doing multitasking. So ultimately, while planning a course, even if I forget one of the things out of these, you know, right, then that won't lead to an effective program outcome or an effective course outcome attainment, right? So if I want an effective course outcome, right, I should do all these things, right, before launching my assessments or before launching my plan to the students, right? So all these things must be checked. So this is where we use the checklist rubric, right? Then is the rating. When you add a scale, a rating scale to a rubric, right? It is called a rating rubric, to which you give the priority, right? Or to which you give the highest rating. 3 being the highest and 1 being the lowest, or 1 being the highest and 3 being the lowest. That depends upon user to user, what you have declared, right? This shows to which things are you looking for at present, right? Say assessment method specified at a rating 1, 2, 3, right? Suppose if you think the assessment method is specified and is final to go now, right, you may rate it 3 as highest, means verified. Assessment nature specified, right? Suppose you think you require a little bit of modification in it, right? You rate it 2, right? That the assessment nature is required to be specified more clearly, right? In order to do it. Objective of the task specified, right? Suppose you didn't specify the objective, you have specified only one objective and there are multiple objectives, those are required to be specified, right? And you give it a rating scale 1. So you will get to know, right, through this rating scale, what are the things which are pending, what are the things under the review, and what are the things which are finalized, right? So this is what rating rubrics is going to help you for. Okay, now is a holistic rubric, and this is what majorly we use, right, while we give the rubrics along with our assessments, right? So have short narrative description of the characteristic, right? What you call is an outstanding work, what you call is an acceptable work, and what you say is not accepted at all, which a student is required to repeat, right? So that a student may get to know if in comparison to somebody else, I'm evaluated or I scored less than somebody, what was that I was required to do more in the examination or in the project or while demonstrating? But then those characteristics should be very well defined, right? In this case, you have two types. Either you can have a single criteria rubric, which has only one dimension, and it is used to assess participants' overall achievement on an activity or item based on the predefined achievement level, right? And the performance descriptions, those are written in the form of paragraphs so that in order to make him understand that better, right? Or in the form of the sentences too. See, this is one of the example of the holistic rubric, right? So this rubrics, it tells about the score at the vertical end, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. When a student is gonna get a score of 1? When is he gonna get a score of 2? When is he gonna get a score of 3 and 4, right? So this rubric that I have shown is for a research paper, right? So if the research paper demonstrates complete understanding and execution of the assigned objectives, right, writing does not spend excessive time on any point of the development at the expense of the development of other point in the body of the paper, or writing is also error-free without ambiguity and reads smoothly, right, then the student scores 4 out of 4 in that, right? But if in case of second, right, criteria 2, research paper demonstrate considerable understanding and execution of the assigned objective, right? Writing exhibits occasional weakness and lapses in the correctness, and writing also has some errors and the ambiguities, but yet does not clearly, yet does read clearly and coherently. Means it is not going to make much difference, thus can be accepted. So in that way, we'll give a score of 3. And the student knows why he got a score of 3, because this was the reason. And similarly for score 2 and score 1. So another is again an example of a holistic rubric for a technical presentation. And this is what we do generally. We take a lot of technical presentation or the demonstrations from the students, right? So the criteria is defined, and if the student right is able to meet that criteria, he get the score, right, which is just next to it. And the student, if he gets a score of 3, he gets to know what is he required to demonstrate in order to reach on to a score of 4. You know, this is another this thing, usage of a rubric, right? Why should we give rubric associated to all sort of demonstration? Next is analytic rubrics, right? So in in engineering or in these education systems, right, we generally use analytic rubrics and holistic rubrics, right? So in case of this analytic rubrics, right, the check boxes of rating scale rubrics, right, which now is being changed to brief descriptions, right? And what are those descriptions? What what performance is required to be exhibited by the students, which is associated to a particular characteristic. Right. So if he meets all the performance criteria, now this is not a single criteria rubric. It is a multiple criteria rubric. The performance exhibited by the student is to be demonstrated or is to be tested through multiple performance criteria. Right. And on the scale of 1 to 5, he got the score and the description of it is there. So analytic rubrics for comm skills, that is the communication skills. So the multiple criteria, performance criteria, a student should be able to write, should be effective in written communication. He should be able to effectively present a visual aid, right? He should be able to give an effective oral presentation. And what about the body language while he is communicating or demonstrating his skills? So if he is proficient in all these criteria, he gets marks between 8 to 10. If it is acceptable, he gets between 5 to 7. But if he needs improvement, he gets marks between 1 to 4. Right. So we have just given an example of the written communication, what he is supposed to do. Right. If he's proficient, the report is well organized, it is very clearly written, right? There are very less spelling mistakes, the diagrams and the analysis, like there is a clarity in that, they are very well presented, right? And the sentences, they are grammatically correct and very less errors are there in the spelling or is free from errors, right? So this is for the written communication. On contrary to it, a report is acceptable if it is clearly organized, right? The most part of it, right? And there are very few errors, but then those are acceptable errors, right? They do not hinder the reader as such, right? So that is acceptable. But a student in which the report lacks an overall organization and reader has to make a considerable effort, to understand.
Shivani ma'am, excuse me.
Yes, ma'am.
Please pause for a moment. I would request the team Chitkara University to please make the chat off for attendees. And then we are going to paste the link of yesterday's assignment, the drive, on the chat window so that everybody can copy and paste it and save it, because it's not possible to email the assignment individually to everyone. A lot of people are writing in the chat window. Team Chitkara, kindly off the chat window responses for the attendees for maybe next 2 to 3 minutes. Thank you, Shivani ma'am. You can continue.
Thank you so much, Archana ma'am. Kindly disable the chat window. Thank you so much. Okay, we'll certainly provide you with the link, right, where you have to put in your assignments. So this is how we prepare your analytics rubric in order to analyze the same, right? So for a design process, this is one template, right, for the analytic rubric, right? What is the purpose of the project? We should be clear about the component, the basis on which we want to evaluate a student, because that component is going to define, right, a student, what exactly is he expected to do, right? So he should define what is the purpose of the student, what is the research items, right? What are the choices that he's making, right? The alternative designs that he's giving for the proposed solution, the application of engineering principle that he's imbibing, right? The final design that he come up with, and what he interpret from it, what solution is he giving? So if it needs improvement, 1 to 4, and all the back blocks which are blank here will include the description of that, right? Under which case would he require the improvement? Under which case this criteria will be acceptable? And under which case we can say that he's proficient in it? So one example for the design project that we are taking for this description, that is the purpose of the project, right? If a student does not clearly explain the intended outcome of the project or provides little information about the problem that he's going to solve, right? In that case, definitely he needs an improvement, right? Because he is not clear about why the project was selected, right? So that's why he needs improvement in that. This purpose of the project statement criteria will be accepted in the case if the student provides a description of intended outcome of the project, which include information about the problem that he was solving, right? And why the project was selected. He'll be said to be proficient, provided a detailed intended outcome of the project, which includes the information about the problem that was being solved, right? Or need being met, and clearly articulates the reasons and the decision-making process used to select the process. Again, for the design project, the rubric, the research, choices, alternative designs, right? These are the descriptors that are there. And these are very well framed, you know, even if you will go through the policy reform document, examination reform documents by AICT, right? These rubrics are very well defined there also, right? So you can use the same rubrics while evaluating for your design projects with a little bit of retweeting in the descriptions. Again, the component, the analytic rubric for the design project with the component of application of engineering principle, right? So when a student would be said to be proficient in it, if he critically selects the application of engineering principle and ensure that he has reasonably used that in his results, right? So it will be acceptable if the effective application of engineering principles will result in a reasonable solution, right? But then he would require improvement if, the erroneous, erroneous application of engineering principle, which is leading to an unreasonable solution, that is a wrong choice, right, of some engineering principle that he is using to give the solution to that particular problem. Right. So what we intend to say is why the rubric and the descriptors in the rubrics are important. Right. They tell student both the things, when the things will be expected, what is he supposed to do and what he is not supposed to do. So it includes all the do's and don'ts that we generally give with anything, right? So he knows if this is going to happen, right, what will be the impact on the result? Result as such is not just the grades. Result as such is also on the outcome that he is expected to exhibit. Okay, the summary of the concluding part of this entire session, right? We have talked about the assessment planning, that assessment planning is the most important feature, right? We talked about that missing, the measuring quotient that was found missing in the traditional cases. You know, we couldn't confidently gauge the strength of connection between a course and a program outcome, right? So imagine you have, you don't have a hallmark jewelry. Right, irrespective of the purity of the gold standards, there will always be a doubt on it, you know. But if a valid measuring quotient, right, it is attached to an entity or an outcome, it becomes hallmark of its existence. And this is what we are doing with that COPO mapping, and why we are including those performance indicators, why we are mapping them to the assessments, ultimately to have graduates of 21st century. Ultimately to cater to the need of your employers, and ultimately to really exhibit what a program is supposed to exhibit. So we also worked on what should be the assessment tasks template, right? And the sample questions, how they are to be aligned with Bloom's level, how they are supposed to get aligned with the COs, right? And the weightage of that, right? And ultimately seeing the structure as well as the quality of the assessment task or the assessment item. And finally, discussing about what is the importance of rubrics and what are the different type of rubric we have. So we have come on to the closure of it, right? So OBE cannot be implemented in isolation, everybody knows. You know, we have to align curriculum, teaching learning process, and assessment. Because these are the three parts of that triangle that Dr. Mantri has very nicely explained, you know, right? That until and unless they are aligned, we can't have a good education process or improved process in line. You know, otherwise, if we just think about what we are doing is, it will be just a data manipulation exercise if we are not aligning these three. Though the course outcome are course dependent, but still we can improvise these to limit to 3 to 6. That is the apt level, you know, for designing any course outcomes for a particular course, rightly. And then strictly, we must use the action verbs as defined by Bloom's taxonomy. The question paper ideally should not have any choice, but in case if you are giving a choice, then it should be between the questions testing the same CO levels. Design activities for professional attributes and also as CO in respective course, right? So that is the important part of it. Assessment planning to be done very meticulously, and the most important is that this planning should be done well in advance, right before the start of semester. Don't think of the semester is going to start and while the semester is going on, and then you are going to add the items into it and then you are going to complete your plan. It is never ever going to work, right? So at that time, what you have to do is, with the feedback that you are getting in real time, you are to present your prospect for the feedback for the change in plan for the next semester, for the next set of students, such that the way in which the program outcomes or the course outcomes are measured is more effective and more accurate. So all the assessment tasks, right, should be designed such that they assess more of higher order thinking skills. See, if we are to give, what is the outcome of an educational institute? It's the students, right? It is our students, those are exhibiting those program outcomes, right? And who's taking our students? It is the employer. So if the need of the employer is to check for beyond the knowledge, check for the professional skills, the other skills associated with that, right? So it becomes really important for us to check and recheck, you know, those skills, test those skills through our assessments also, right? The lastly, a rubric must be in place once the assessment is designed. So while designing the assessment, you consider that that assessment has to be designed in two parts. Part A, the assessment task that you are giving in the form of the question or in the form of the statements or in the form of the case studies to the student, and part B is associated rubric with it, which define what is expected from those students, right? Even for the fixed hour examination, you know, we should have a rubric that is a holistic rubric. Higher expectation is the key. Very rightly said, you know, this was the fourth pillar, right? And one of the most important pillar of OBE that Dr. Jadu talked about, that we are expecting really higher, right? From the faculty, the one who's teaching a course, and also from the students to whom that course is being taught, right? In order to have expanded opportunities for our advanced learners. With this, we come to an end of the session, right? And we are 2 minutes advance.
I will just once again pitch in, Shivani ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
A lot of comments in the chat box regarding the assignments. I would like to clarify that we are going to send an email to all the registered email IDs only with the attachment of both the assignments of day one and day two, and the link to the drive where these assignments, your answers can be uploaded, will also be shared in the email, say by 3 p.m. today. The link to access to the drive where you have to upload your assignments is free. So do not ask for any access permissions individually on the mail from where you are getting an email into your inboxes. We have already made the access free. for your uploading. So this is from my side, because there were a lot of questions and questions in the question answer chat window. So we are going to send an email. This is for the information of all concerned. Thank you very much, Shivani ma'am. You can continue.
Thank you so much, Archana ma'am. Thank you very much. Right. So that was it. Let us see if we have any queries. We have two questions on the window. Okay. So okay, those are the thanksgiving messages actually. Thank you very much, everyone. Would you have any queries? Let me check it out. Let's scroll it.
There is a question regarding where the slides or PPT will be available, where the webinar can be available. So the webinar is being streamed live on Chitkara University YouTube. We will share the link of the same in the email. We will make sure that we also share the link of the complete webinar YouTube link also in the email. Thank you for pointing it out. We will do that. Thank you.
So there's another question regarding today's quiz. We don't have today's any quiz for today. Thank you very much, everyone.